31st. Madam Clerk?
Will the board members who are present please respond? Ms. Doar? Mr. Barlow? Mr. Bourne? Mr. Young? Ms. Cosby? Ms. Carter? Ms. Owen? Dr. Sapini? Mrs. Page?
Here.
You have a quorum, Madam Chair. If there's anyone here who needs interpretive services?
¿Hay alguien presente que desea servicios en español? De inglés a español, perdón.
Madam Chair, I have one amendment to the agenda, and that is to add closed session for legal.
Okay. What is the board's pleasure? Need a motion to amend? Second. We have a motion to amend the agenda, Ms. Owen, and seconded by Dr. Sapini. All in favor? None opposed? Next item.
The next item is item two, public information, 2.01, receive public comment on the superintendent's estimate of needs.
At this time, we'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight to share to provide input regarding the superintendent's estimate of needs. So if we have anyone in the audience that would like to speak to this, please come forward. If you're speaking as an individual, you have 3 minutes. Please state your name, write your name, and you have 3 minutes to provide input. If you're speaking on behalf of a group, you have 5 minutes.
Good evening, Dr. Pat. My name is Susan Davern, and I have had the pleasure of addressing the board in the past regarding pay scales and arts education. I'm in that 7% of your instructional staff who have served Richmond Public Schools for over 30 years. And while there's been a perception that veteran staff are part of the problem at RPS and that new rooms sweep clean, the rest of the adage is that old rooms know where the dirt is. So I would like to be allowed to stir up a bit of the dirt. Perhaps I'm wrong, but this is my perception. The issue that I would like to address tonight concerns the addition of 6 additional professional development days to the school calendar. Teachers are generally not in favor of this and are skeptical of the ruse of getting a raise or decompression of salary by working additional 6 days. That happened in the past. Professional development days, you need to know, are social events. You get to see people you only see 1 or 2 times a year. You get more than 20 minutes for lunch. And you get to talk all day long to people over the age of 18. You check the good column, not to want to offend anyone. You take a few notes later forgotten. And then you get rushed and resentful of not having enough time to plan and prepare for your classes. And every year past the first Tuesday in November is Professional Development Day. Last year, when I had to take 2 days for a family issue, I received an email from the superintendent's office reminding me that professional development was an obligation and that I would be docked the days paid for missing one in the future. In 32 years, I've missed 2 professional development days. I did not feel I needed to be chastised. This year, the first Tuesday in November, was a parent-teacher conference before report cards. We had a 2-hour workday after the first interim, and tomorrow we have a 2-hour workday to finalize grades. Then we have a professional development day on Monday. Why could we not have that day to really plan for a new semester, rather than attending a mandatory
We understand that you're not getting ready these days out of the regular school year calendar. Is in order to provide the greatest opportunity for the design process of learning, which is to learn a new concept or skill at the beginning of the year and then implement it in the classroom, get together with your colleagues, reevaluate, reassess, and then continue that process until it's perfected. What about giving us some full days for teacher work days at the end of the long-term year so that we can deal with the grading papers and exams, putting in grades and preparing for the next semester or the next 9 weeks without having to teach part of the day and or have meetings. Simply put, yes, we recognize, understand, and want high-quality, relevant professional development that will help us improve our ability to provide high-quality instruction for our students. We would like to improve the current system. Before you add additional days, use the current system that we have. Yes, we understand that we will be paying for the additional days, but adding additional days is adding more work, and it still does not improve our overall pay. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Tom Hartman. I'm speaking as an individual. The average term of an urban superintendent is 3.2 years. This is insane. Quoting the executive director of the Council of Great City Schools, Michael Cassidy, this continued churn makes it harder for urban school systems to maintain and accelerate the positive academic momentum that they have created over the past several years. We have the right team. Let us be about our triumph. As I mentioned last time, if you demand that an apple orchard produce apples 3 years after planting, you will be forever disappointed. Does this mean that I agree with everything? Of course not. One does not plant apple trees and then just sit back. I think our professional development program still needs improvement, and I do not mean by adding more days of the same. Let me speak for a particular, superb, experienced teacher, multiple times teacher of the year for her or his school. Call him Philip Roth. I approximately quote Roth. Again, in his mouth. Please do not add more days of the same old PD. PD has simply gone from D minus before to more D minus now. Add instructional time or add common planning time instead of more PD. We need more time to work with our particular students and to prepare to work with our particular students. And for heaven's sake, differentiate PD so that teachers are getting the development they specifically want and need. Way too much one size fits all in PD. It's insulting and counterproductive to have seasoned teachers receiving the same professional development as beginners. Here's a footnote from me myself. I do tend to give PD sessions high evaluations. To me, I am giving marks to a well-meaning colleague, often a dragoon colleague. I am supporting that colleague, not the overall PD program. Survey the staff directly, and I think you will find that more of the same professional development is less popular than Betsy DeVos for Secretary of Education.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Heather Crone, and I've been teaching in RPS for 20 years. I understand that you have many decisions to make regarding this year's budget, and I also understand that there are many options being presented having to do with additional professional development time for teachers. I would like to speak from personal experience. District-wide professional development has not been effective. Sessions are offered by our colleagues, and while we appreciate their efforts to share their expertise, many times the topics do not correlate directly with our own classroom instruction or subject areas. Also, we often find ourselves scrambling to find any session that isn't overcrowded, leading to limited choices. After several days of these sessions, most teachers I know are frustrated and disheartened. We do not see these days as the most beneficial use of our time, especially at the beginning of the school year when we could be doing so many things to get our classes ready for our students. What do we need? We need more time to collaborate with our colleagues in our school and within our departments. While we are all RPS, there are things which make each school unique. We need to be able to work with our staff and principal to create professional development opportunities that will benefit us in our schools. We need more time to plan the creative, challenging lessons our students deserve. We need more time to complete grading. We need the autonomy to find and pursue professional development that works for each one of us. For example, I teach advanced placement literature and I attend college board training regularly. For me, those training sessions are time well spent. Thank you for everything you're doing to make RPS a great school district. The teachers here, from everything I've seen, are committed and passionate about what they do. So we need you to help us be even better with a reasonable and measured approach to professional development. More isn't always better. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Kenneth Williams, and I'm more or less in the gutter, so to speak. My whole function as a community activist is in the gutter. For example, Thanksgiving Day, we were serving meals on Chamberlain Parkway under the bridge. You know, and we counseled mothers of children who were homicide victims. You know, so it's relevant. I mean, we are primarily a reentry organization. We provide skill sets to men and women with felony convictions, and we provide skill sets, more importantly, to at-risk youth between the ages of 16 and 30. And we extended it, we had 16 to 25, but we extended it to 30 because we're finding out a lot of our young people are getting out of prison at around 5 years beyond the 25-year limit we had set for ourselves. You know, so we're finding out that reentry is an open door to homelessness, poverty, wife battery, you know, and as a young child growing up, you know, I can remember, now today I'm 68 years old, but right now I get emotional feelings when I remember going to school and all my little buddies I played with in school, in my class, you know, when I came to greet them and meet them, they had their mother and father. You know, I had just my mother. And nobody knew what I was going through, man. And right today, 60 years later, it still affects me. You know, so my concern is with that $22 million, you know, I was invited here from I'm a member of the Crusade for Voters, and I was invited here, and it was a mission of $22 million. And I would like to see that 10% of the $22 million to go into a student scholarship fund. You know, and I think that fund should be open to the whole community where people can pour into it. You know, I'm one that I don't, you know, suggest something without putting myself in it. So as CEO of the Adult Attorney Program, I pledge, if that happens, to donate a certain amount, a certain percentage of every dime that comes through our program into that fund. You know, let me tell you about Robert, and then I'm gonna sit down. Robert, how much time?
30 seconds.
30 seconds. Robert went through high school, he graduated with scholars, he was a student, a president of the student body, and when he came home to a mother working at McDonald's on receiving a welfare check, and a father who's in Greenville Correctional Center. So Robert ended up on the streets. 2 years ago, Robert was found dead, shot 5 times over in Howland Park. So I'm saying that we have intelligent students who are capable to be successful if the opportunity presents itself to go into college. So I think we need to kind of open the door and make that happen. Thank you.
Thank you.
Kenneth Williams, turn the program.
Do we have any other members in the audience that would like to speak? Seeing that we have none, next item.
The next item is item 3, informational reports. Discuss the superintendent's FY18 estimated needs and the 2018-2022 CIP budgets.
Board members. Chair and board members, tonight we want to take this opportunity to further connect some dots, get the board up to speed with answering some of the questions previously. The first thing I'd like to do is kind of set the framework. One of the things that we shared early on was the fact that this type of transition does not lend itself well given the way the structure is set up. It's like you're having a drink from a fire hydrant in a short period of time to make some important decisions. But I would also like to ask that you can consider and frame in your mind the challenge that sits before the administration as you were tasked with a task. You're bound by code to follow that until some other action is taken. And so you have to implement what you were told to implement until some other formal action is taken. Additionally, challenge with 8 new people who
different places and what they understand or don't understand about school systems and how they operate. So the challenge is often is that one person, two people comprehend and get more of it quicker, and others need more time and information. So the challenge has been is trying to craft a dialogue and a presentation that meets the needs of nine different people. And at the same time, be conscious of the audience that you're dealing with, because this is a public school district. So we, after talking to the board chair, one of the things we wanted to do was answer some questions that she shared was posed about, you know, the academic improvement plan, and then move forward, obviously, with the conversation about the two big items that you asked for additional data, which was the middle school overage undercredited, and professional development. A lot of assumptions were made, I think, about a number of those things that, unfortunately, the can had not gone that far down the road. Additionally, you received a lot of information. You received a lot of data on Friday to give you an opportunity to pre-read. But I start with the idea of improving schools involves everyone. You know, joint school improvement and accountability is success. There is no one person that can make this school district successful. And as you see on the local school side, you see a variety of people that play a role, but significantly that are the two people in red, the two the groups highlighted in red, superintendent and school board, informing leadership and guiding the district. But we also got the accountability piece, we also got the community piece, but it's all about relationships and it's all about leadership. You early on were presented with information regarding our the basic requirements of the school board when it comes to having a comprehensive long-range plan. That's not an option. That is by state code if we are to honor and do what we're supposed to do as a school division. Division-wide comprehensive, unified long-range plan based on data collection, analysis, and it is intended to improve classroom instruction. Student achievement is a core focus of having plans put in place. And the comprehensive plan is supposed to consider any other plans both at the local, state, and federal level. So the question came about where's the district strategic plan? And I wanted to make sure we're all on the same page about what a strategic plan is. You know, it's a set of priorities that focus the energies and resources, strengthen operations, but it has common goals and agreement upon intended outcomes and results. The plan itself is put into a document intended to communicate the organization's goals and actions needed to be successful and meet those goals. But what's key is there are many different frameworks, methodologies, and there is no absolute rule or right framework. Now, all this information is not Dr. Ben saying it, it's about the Institute of Balanced Scorecard. That's one of the things they share as you go about developing a strategic plan. One thing they have in common generally is four significant parts: analysis or assessment, strategy formulation, strategy execution, evaluation, and sustainment, which is part of the management phase. So to answer the question that several of you all have asked and some of the community have asked is, why do we go about developing an academic improvement plan? First and foremost, let's start with arriving into the district in the middle of the previous board's tenure. So not at the beginning, at the middle. At that time, it was limited to no staff. In fact, we were pretty much thin, razor thin, not even a staff in place to do anything. We had a number of temps in place, a number of people who were looming to retire, looming towards retirement. And most importantly, the current plan was sunsetting that very next year, in 2015. There was no identifiable previous action taken that we could find that says we were in the process of updating the plan. So in essence, there wasn't a team in place from an administrative standpoint to work on updating the plan. I can't speak to prior, almost 2 years prior to arriving here, and why work wasn't done, what was done, and what not was done. But the administration did talk about the need for what was the work that's gonna be done on a strategic plan. And at the end of the day, you know that from your recent training with VSBA, from what the state code says, and also from the handbook we gave you, that starts at a governance level, not an administrative level. We become the nuts and bolts behind it. And so we also, ultimately, the superintendent work for the school board, not the other way around. AIP was not intended to be a new strategic plan, but it attempted to connect the existing plan where possible to honor the work that had been done by previous people in the district, by the previous board, and all the community members that participated. But we knew that we needed a research-based plan, and it's key to understand that it became the plan that we were operating on as a school division. It wasn't an administration plan. It wasn't Dr. Ben's plan. It wasn't Mrs. Kane's plan. Once the board adopted and approved it, it became the division's plan. And I share that because often you hear words about Dr. Ben's plan or, you know, this person's plan. It was a blueprint that the district was operating on to set priorities, to focus the energy, focus resources and requests. And in fact, the city council said to us, it was much more clear why we were asking for more money and what we were asking money for by having an academic improvement plan. And the key is it was an academic focus, not a complete strategic plan. It was meant to strengthen our operations and establish goals that we were supposed to work towards. And it also created agreement around intended outcomes and results, which you will see later. And then ultimately, it was about assessing and adjusting RPS's direction. Simply stated, the purpose had to do with accelerating the progress of all students. The goal was to increase academic achievement and reduce achievement gaps. And it was academic standards developed for implementing a plan was based on the 5 core practices. Most importantly, the 5 core practices came from research-based practices from ACT's National Center for Education Achievement. It was evidence-based practices. And here's the framework. It had 5 core themes that were applied to develop what were the actions that were supposed to happen at the division level, the school level, and in the classroom level. At your desk, you received a document that had the critical actions behind those areas that actually defined what was supposed to happen at each level to move student achievement. The connection. When considering the academic improvement plan, again, we actually considered the current state of affairs in RPS. We actually looked at the strategic plan. Administratively, we looked at it and pulled it out. In various places throughout the AIP, you will see where possible that there was a crosswalk made to the previous strategic plan. Again, not to throw the baby out with the bathroom. One of the criticisms and the challenges that have been articulated by the Council of Great City Schools and other urban researchers is that urban settings continue to struggle because they reset every time there's a change in leadership. They start over. So they never make any continuous improvement. What that has done is created ever-changing tides, constant turnover changes, and again, the people who suffer ultimately are our children and our families at the end result. The district has to have some continuity and continuation of understanding what it is we're working on, what it is we're going to ask for resources, and put things aside that don't support those goals and objectives that we're trying to meet. As I said, it was research-based. The framework that you saw earlier came from a reputable organization, and again, it was ACT-NCEA. They looked at 479 school systems when they developed this document and looked at the consistent performance. They even looked at research from noted researchers about what constituted continuous school improvement and what actually was working. Most important and significant was that it was a variety of school districts, not just one type of school district. And in Richmond, we have schools that are very points and places of success. Just for Kids did a review, and there's a handout in your packet too that talks about what Just for Kids found when they did a review of the framework. And these are the things they said. It provided a structure for organizational functions, most directly impacting improvement of instruction. Features were observable, interdependent practices found to be present in different quantity or quality, and consistently high-performing systems. And the key word is the system. We have 44 schools, but what we found, and I found when I got here, is we were operating in silos, not working as a system. But yet, as you know, we're pulling data, and we have schools that have 30-35% transient rate population. So if they go from one school that's not functioning on a certain level, there's going to be a challenge in creating success. It was a composite built from the ideal cases. Contains findings emanating from schools with somewhat varied demographics in a number of states. Most importantly, what I liked about it was not trying to sell programs and strategies that we had to adopt. It was a framework to take what you had and improve upon it. So it was not someone coming in and saying, you gotta buy this and gotta buy that to make it work. That was something we didn't need at the time. And you can see the rest, but a big part about it was provide critical actions, which is an important part of a good plan, of the things that are supposed to happen at the district level, the school level, and the classroom level. We had performance targets to the external report. We measure more than this, but it was a three-year, multi-year plan, not an instantaneous success opportunity. We obviously, at the time, were asked to look at the state accountability, and remember, this was something that was asked for by city council also, by the city. So the measures at the time had to do with how are we doing with the number of schools being accredited, our federal accountability with annual measurable objectives, early childhood readiness using our PALS data, our participation in advanced programs, and that was all about the equity lens that even this board has talked about, making sure that our kids had equity of access to those types of programs. The number of students who were leaving us and going on to post-secondary opportunities, our career and technical education completion rate, and specifically completion, because we're looking at children who completed a full two-year program, not someone who just walked in, took an exam, and got a credential. That was basically based on our own skill and ability, as opposed to assessing were we making or helping our children get better in their career readiness. Of course, attendance rate, and obviously at the end of the day, our kids and whether they're graduating. The funding. So people ask, why is it working or is it working? Well, here's the interesting dynamic. The academic improvement plan was a request for a $23.5 million investment over a three-year period, which averaged to $7.8 million. In truth, some of those were baseline dollars, and once you put them in there, you didn't have to allocate again. So the true reoccurring cost was really only $11.03 million. That's really what it came down to in the end. The plan has never been fully funded. The plan has received limited funding. In fact, when we did the analysis, all we've gotten is 23% of the funding. 23%. So I ask you to keep that in mind when you ask the question, is it working or why is it not working? RPS, originally the original plan, was only initially able to identify $900,000. And we continued to struggle the budget and ultimately came up with $1.8 million that we redirected towards the plan. To answer the question, how did you help yourself? Which amounts to really $3.6 million over the past 2 years. The results. The first year when the funds were not received, the media asked the question, what do you expect to happen, Dr. Bennett? What is the likelihood of your success? And my answer was, you're gonna have mixed results and slow progress. And that's what we've had. Those things that are in green mean we've hit or exceeded the performance expectation. The year before we arrived, there were 11 schools fully accredited, we're now at 17. But then you look at the reading scores. Had some growth, minimal, that's what yellow means. The math at 3 percentage point growth. We declined in our PALS early childhood, but we also know that the other thing that contributed to that is we jumped from about 800 kids to 1,200 kids in our early childhood program. So we're taking in more children. But we're okay with that because we believe the sooner we get them, the better off they will be. So we're going to take a hit on some of the academic performance. Our dual enrollment increased by 127 students. The PSAT 10. Had a slight decrease after having a large increase in the number of students in the first year of implementation. But we also shifted to a different model. Number of students in AP declined. IB showed a huge jump in participation the first year, the second year, it dropped, so a net gain of only 7 students. So small growth, the yellow. Same thing in our four-year college. CTE completers dropped, but we had a large increase in numbers also. And then ultimately our graduation rate saw a 0.9% original increase, and then a net gain over the 2 years of 0.2 was a change. So you see mixed results in our data for a plan that received 23% of its request. Yes, ma'am. No, the school board had to cut because they didn't get the funding they asked for. They asked for all of it, is what happened. And ultimately, we had to reduce because of the allocation that was provided, and that's what they had to move.
Did you turn it on? I'll speak louder. So, the amount that was eventually allocated to the AIP, because you can get the full request, was $2.7 million.
Correct.
And then you were able to find an additional $1.8 million within the budget by cutting other areas. Is that correct?
Cutting or redirecting?
Redirecting. Yes. So the total is 2.7 plus 1.8.
Yes.
Got it.
Ultimately, when you hear the description of what happens between February 6th, like you're going through, so we continue to work. So we continue to work to find more savings during that time, which we will continue during this time. When you set forward your budget, we don't stop looking for ways to support our initiatives within our budget. And we will continue the same process.
Just one follow-up question. I feel like we've had good visibility into the 2.7 from the additional PD days plus the Aspire program. When you get to it, it'd be helpful to understand what the 1.8 million went to.
It's going to come.
Great.
So the big question is there similarity or differences? One of the things that I shared with the board directly is that you have two potentially new documents that are coming down the road. You have one current document, and you have one past document. And one of the reasons we wanted to share this with you is that I hope that there's a conversation about what about all those things would help formulate what are the goals that we go forward. Because in essence, you know that the division level review is coming March 17th, and those are the five areas that they're going to address from the state. You've agreed to work on the education compact, which by the definition of what was set forward, was to create a shared framework for relationships around the goals and metrics between the city and the school district. And I would say that when that work is done, what happens here and what happens here, we want to make sure not in conflict with each other. And support each other. When you look at the color coding, what we did was show you the similarities between the documents. The only thing that doesn't have a color coding, obviously, is that change impact, because it's not done. When you look at the things that are related to academic instruction, those are all in green. When you look at human resources expectations, they're all in red. When you look at infrastructure support systems and those types of things that support, they're in blue. So there are similarities in all of the documents that exist. The question is, what about them are the most important things that this board will obviously need to decide what's important to this board. But I would ask that when we look at the lens of whether you decide to re-engage and rebuild around here, that you keep in mind these two things that are coming down the pipe and make sure there's connection, which will make our job clear and easy as an administration. So to get to the question about what was funded, which was a question we were asked to share with you all, Mr. Meyer.
Thank you, Ben. Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board. Let's try to provide some clarity and maybe a little higher level view initially, and then we'll drill down. What I thought we would do is talk in broad terms about the resources that were identified as being needed for the academic improvement plan. And primarily there were four broad areas. Understanding that we have a number of our middle schoolers that are not being successful, a number of our high schoolers that are not being successful, looking at the offerings that we have with regard to languages and arts to try to give our students the opportunity to be successful in college and career, and also understanding that we teach the children in Richmond. We don't teach children in Fairfax or Virginia Beach or Atlanta, Georgia. We teach Richmond children, and to try to give our teachers, whether that's through in-service days or through technology-based professional development, to try to give our teachers the best tools that we can to try to reach our children. So again, four large areas broken into five teams. Team one was focused on curriculum development and assessment. Team two broken down into actual live professional development and purchase tools for professional development. Team 3 focused on the teachers and support for electives, arts, and languages. Team 4 looking at instructional coaches and assessments of are we hitting the targets, and Team 5 focused on the overage and undercredited high schools and middle schools. So as a big picture, the original request, and we're going to talk about how this kind of boils down to $11 million in just a second. This was what was originally presented the first year, fiscal 16, $9.5 million, and you'll see the second year, 7.6, 6.3, and a total of just about $23.5 million. This was what was funded with the new dollars in fiscal 16, and except for the redirected funds, which we can talk about in just a moment, there have been no additional funds since this original funding. And this is what the new funds were used for: 3 professional development days, and to implement our Aspire program that's currently at the Richmond Technical Center. These were the 13 positions that were put in place to start our Aspire program. And again, this was the funding, the new funding that we received in fiscal 16. So this is the 23% that Dr. Bedden referenced. These numbers look a little odd because this is the way that the state presents their budget, and we'll talk about that. So you can see a cumulative effect: the first year, $9.5 million, the second year, 7.6, or a total investment over the 2 years of $17 million, $6 million for the third year, total investment over the 3 years of $23 million. We received the 2.7 in both 16 and 17. So you'll see the percent of new funding is 23%. Breaking that down into something that we're all a little more familiar with, you see across the top of the $23 million, what was presented originally included the professional development days in year 2 and year 3. It also included some upgrade of technology in year 2. But when we look at recurring budgets versus recurring funding, really the total request was right at $11 million, and the new funding was 2.7. Or 24%. I can pause at this moment and I'll ask what the board's pleasure is. We did a full, complete reconciliation of the entire original academic improvement plan to every position and every dollar that has either been new funding that's been received or redirected funding, to try to provide something that was not terribly convoluted for the public tonight. We didn't put all that reconciliation in here. I can talk about it, or we can provide that reconciliation to the board tonight or tomorrow. So I'll look to Ms. Doerr and look to the board about how you'd like to proceed with that.
So this is for the 1.6, the additional 1.6 million.
And I have a list if we want to talk about it.
Is it, I mean, could you just broadly talk about what programs it went to? I mean, did it go to PD days? Did it go to?
I can. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
When you talk about team 1, team 2, is that in relationship to team 1 and team 2 in AIP?
They are. That's exactly what it
okay.
is.
Thank you.
Absolutely. So the idea behind that was that we would recruit from places that had the teachers that we need. So say, for example, our Latina population is increasing in some of our schools, but we don't have a pool of Latina teachers to draw from. So that would create an opportunity for us to go to universities, cities that have historically Latina teachers. This is just one example, and hire from that pool. So that was an opportunity to do that. ESOL teachers, teachers in high needs areas, so STEM, math, and some of the sciences, that's what that was created for.
I'd like to talk a little bit about the redirected $1.8 million. The two big items were the two big items were providing technology access in 8 classrooms. That was $650,000. Also, the second big item was just about $500,000 for, let me get the exact title. This is for software support for our students. As I'm looking for the title of the software, it's about $32,000 a month for the software, and it is specifically to support the overage, undercredited students. Find that in 1 second. The other couple of items are outside contracted support for professional development.
Advanced Path.
Advanced Path, it
is an online program that allows students to learn at their own pace and oftentimes accelerated pace so that we can get the students graduated.
So those specifically, those were dollars that we weren't able to replace computers, replace servers, upgrade our student information system. We had to defer that so we could outfit these classrooms. Also, we took other federal dollars that we could have used for other types of direct instruction, and we prioritize this and put that in. And again, if it pleases the board, we have a full dollar for dollar position by position reconciliation. We just didn't put it up on the screen tonight to try to keep it as simple as we could. So to recap, very limited funding, but a very comprehensive plan. Focused on our highest need students and very much focused on trying to provide our teachers with an expanded tool set. Total cost at $11 million. Roughly half of that was focused on, again, trying to provide professional development in some fashion for our teachers. The original proposal, as I think everybody here knows, was 9 professional development days in service. At this moment, there's 3, and there are 4 alternatives for professional development that Dr. Ben is going to talk about. Continuing on in the current year, the superintendent requested the school board approve the continuation of the academic improvement plan. And you'll follow, you'll see team 2, team 3, team 4, and team 5 very much focused on overage, undercredited middle schoolers with team 5. And you'll see at the bottom, the 6 professional development days were not included in this year's budget, the 17 budget. As we took a look ultimately at the economic conditions that were in place as we were working through this budget. And you'll see there was no funding in 17, either new or redirected for the academic improvement plan. Continuing on into 18, something we will talk about later tonight as we get back into our actual budget, kind of get in there, mix it up, get our hands dirty. We will talk about the academic improvement plan that is in the superintendent's estimate of needs at $5.2 million. And all of these things should begin looking very familiar to you. Again, thinking about the big picture, overaged, undercredited, high needs, unsuccessful high schoolers, unsuccessful middle schoolers, trying to provide our teachers with a tool set, and looking at college and career ready opportunities with regard to languages and arts for our students. So this is really an overview, not trying to get into too much detail with regard to the history of the academic improvement plan and the request for funding. And I'm happy to answer the question before Dr. Vedin comes back up and continues on with some further discussion. Yes, ma'am.
One of the things walking into Richmond was understanding that change is a process. It's not, you know, just send an email or a text and say that things are going to change overnight. It's a process you go through. But I do want to close out before we get back to it, as you make a decision about the overage of the credit. That is also, if you think about it broadly, is going to be a culture and climate issue in our schools that our teachers are struggling with. When you look at the number of children who are sitting in some of our schools who are 2 and 3 years older than what they should be sitting in schools, that is not a healthy situation for our classroom and our teachers to be trying to address. So it was also meant to be a school culture and climate along with an academic change. Continuing to have the students report to the same place where they're not being successful was an exercise in futility. And it was not helping us as an institution, nor our classroom teachers, nor the other students who were there who are also trying to get an education. So simply stated, when you think about the three phases of the change process, we looked at our current state, we were trying to move out of our current state, which was not a good state to be. And ultimately, we're in a transition state. As the research talks about it, a transition state is messy and disorganized, unpredictable, constantly in flux, emotionally charged, and emotionally ranging from despair to anxiety to anger and fear. That's a part of the change process. We are working to try to move to our future state. But this is where we are. And we see all those characteristics quite often. Things change quickly, and they can explode. Unfortunately, sometimes they're purposeful. Things are done intentional to change things and create an explosion, to blow it up and start over. Sometimes they're accidental. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're bad. Sometimes they're de-stress, sometimes they're eustress. So the big question that we're at a crossroad is what to really do. What do we do? So as you're gonna move into the nitty-gritty, as Mr. Myers talked about, one of the things I want you to consider, this is the current data that you were previously set about the current state of affairs with our overage and undercredited students. The number is continuing to get worse. And then you see the data associated with our students with disability. Again, you received this previously. I think that's part of the conversation this evening, because you asked for that data that you wanted to have, that you, again, I didn't put all that other stuff behind it to not, you know, death by data process. You got that to read on your own with the more drill down by school and all the other information. Then a big topic tonight was the professional development situation. So I want to put some context too that you probably don't know. When I got here, and one of the things when you're in school improvement, you get a bigger lens put on you. You have the number of schools that we are having school improvement status. And one of the things that came out of that conversation and review is that the state has a really clear code that says teachers get a 200-day contract. The first thing we found is we weren't writing really 200-day contracts in Richmond. We got it. We had to fix that. Secondly, we wanted, following the code and the language, about 180 days of instruction for the students, and then 20 days that was supposed to encompass a variety of things. Parent-teacher conferences, professional development days that talks about it, all the things that you're supposed to do to account for the 200 days that teachers are supposed to be their contract. So we moved to fix that. When we got here, teachers asked actually for more time. So we put it in there at a request. It was not our just our bright idea to say, we just wanted to do this. We heard that it wasn't good. We also heard the cries that we have all of these things we have to do for school improvement we didn't have any time to work on. Again, this is supposed to be a system, not individuals. But this is what was said. We got to do these school improvement plans. We got to do all of the stuff with the data and all those things that we're required to do that's beyond the normal school because of school improvement. There never has been a proposal for 6 days in lieu of the decompression. It was always a plan for decompression in addition to compensation for the days. In fact, the idea was because we had to account for the 200 days, that if the additional work days, or professional development days or work days, you know, we're not stuck on any one model, that we wouldn't have to adhere to the 90 minutes to make sure that we had time to work as a team. One of the challenges that when schools did school improvement, everybody didn't show up. And that was one of the conversations. That was one of the things we got dinged on, too, when the state would come in and do reviews. Was it a complete school effort to work on the academic plan that they were supposed to do school improvement? The other item in our mind was that if we were going to have our teachers do more, and right now they're having to work the 90 minutes is built into their day. The idea for the additional days was also, if you gotta spend more time at work, we thought they deserved to be compensated for it. And that was the intent of the additional days. The average teacher would receive about $275 per day. That's based on our average salary. So depending on where you are, you can get more, you can get less. But if you just take the average amount, step one would jump to $46,175. Midpoint step 20 jumps to $55,000 salary. And then step 40 jumps to $73,000 teacher pay. You did all six. We always said that this was a work in progress. But we also adjusted to what teachers gave us as feedback. Teachers asked for us to include their own colleagues to do the workshops. That's how that came about. The challenge that we face is how we meet the needs of 2,000 people, but still maintain a systemic approach. So someone said about having teacher input. When I asked the staff, show me the latest list of the Professional Development Council. It has approximately 40 people on it, 17 of which are teachers. They have an RAA representation of principals. The goal was to build a systemic professional capacity. It was supposed to be a combination of school-based and district-wide professional development for teachers. There's the cost numbers that I just spoke about, same thing with 275. There was a needs assessment document that you saw. So there was a needs assessment done and responded to, it was worked to respond to that document. Some of the topics include those things that are listed. At the end of the day, if it's added or not, our goal was to respond to the teacher's request for more time to get their compensation. So we're not stuck on any one way. So I want the board to understand that and the teachers to understand that. I asked one of the colleagues who I went to visit personally, is the answer to not do it, or is the answer to continue to develop a plan to do it better? Or some idea or combination of that. So the conversation was about the responses and the data. Well, this is an example of what the district-wide professional development response was for 1,649 responses. That was in your packet. And it speaks for yourself. We have a professional responsibility, to be honest. If we're going to be a data-driven district, as a leadership team, we look at the data. I actually look at this information. Our team looks at this information to make informed decisions about what to do or not to do for our teachers. Then it was broken out. It wasn't just whether it was good or bad. There were areas that talked about, you know, goal objective, new content and skills, whether they gained new content and skills, whether it related to raising student achievement, whether the materials were engaging and active. So it wasn't just, is it good, bad, or different? There were breakout areas for them to speak to. The scale was 1 to 5. Those were the ratings. And again, the only point here is we actually look at the data to try to form what we do. This was the past year, and there were a whole bunch. There were like 9 areas. I just gave you 5 of them to show that there was a section on school quality, a section on school session content, delivery, relevance. Relevance is, did it make any relevance relevant to you? And new information, did it provide any new information? Again, responding to the data. And again, we will always say that we haven't arrived. This is a work in progress. We have not arrived. And we look at the information, try to inform and make better informed decisions. I would encourage, no matter what happens, whether there's more days or not, at the end of the day, honest feedback is important because that's what drives what we do. It's no different than when we try to create more conference format. We move it to online, we try to get more choices rather than everybody going to the same thing. But at the same time of trying to get more choices and be responsive to our teachers, we were struggling to build technology capacity to do that, but we still were committed to doing that. And yes, like any conference, some sessions are better than others. And if you look at those assessments and make a decision about whether that person gets to come back or not. So one of the questions was, what are some possible choices of how to use the data? Clearly, you can go for all 6. And we always have a plan for multiple days, just like we had last year. We didn't think going in and we were sure that we'd get all 9 days we all asked for. So in administration, we always plan on a variety of choices of days to be prepared for what if happens. Again, this is what would happen after you sent your request forward, and we continue to work on from February 6th until you finally get a response from the mayor and then ultimately from the council. But Plan A talked about if you had 6 days, one being a flex day, and there's some possibility of what the days would be. And this was in your frequently asked questions back. Plan B was only use 3 days. And those are the possibility of the days. We agreed context that we prefer them to be more during the year rather than adding more to the beginning or the end. Here's the challenge. You only got so many spots you can put days to stay within 180 days without extending the school year. So it has the potential how many days you put it in, you just extended your school year because the students have got to have 180 days for 990 hours. And we dare to risk reducing our hours for the sake of the fact that 1 year we got 7 snow days. We didn't have to make them up because we had enough hours to absorb it. What we did lose was instructional time. Plan C, we just had 1 day. And maybe it's October 9th or December 18th. And then here's Plan D, the technology option. We can use potentially a big chunk of the money to address what we found in our first significant choice professional development district-wide, that when they tried to use technology in those sessions, all of our teachers were in varied places of what the status of their technology or equipment. We can actually move to a one-to-one capacity where every teacher gets to issue a laptop. We have one dedicated day for the technology training, and then we go to each year of upgrades and uploads. Spend part of the money to purchase and develop an online suite, for lack of a better term. One example is what Ms. Kane had in her previous district, what they call PD in pajamas, where you actually get to do it. We just set a window of time that you must do X, Y, and Z and get it done. And then we do what we struggle with each year we lost funding for, is using the other half of the money to actually work on upgrading our safety and security technology. We continually try to stash away or acquire money to upgrade all our camera systems in our schools because there are a variety of different versions. We're not sure why they end up being a school-based responsibility, not a district-wide responsibility. It allows us to upgrade some other areas for safety and security. But we need to build in a line item, because when you put these things out, you still got to have a maintenance and new purchase and repair purchase line item to make sure you sustain them all. One of the challenges that I've noticed in Richmond is we'll roll out a new project, but don't put money in to sustain the project. Like, we build a new building, and quite honestly, as Mr. Kranz will tell you with the CIP, there has been no real investment in what are we going to do to sustain the human eye and the MLK in those new buildings. We don't have a dedicated line item to do those things. So if we go around this path, some of the money will need to be a dedicated line item with a stage dedicated to that. And of course, we're going to have to address personnel, because we're going to have personnel available to service and support the schools with the technology. And this is separate from, as some of you heard about, the potential with a one-to-one initiative at the high school level with SRAM. If that happens, we're going to have staffing needs, we're going to have reoccurring issues with repair and maintenance that potentially may come up, and we're going to have to, as I said in the first meeting when they came in and met with the city, be careful how fast we move, because we can give kids devices, but our teachers are going to be ready to help use those devices to support instruction if they don't get the support and training on how to implement it in the classroom. So those are some examples, and of course, the one is don't request any of it and cut it out on the request to decrease your request by $3.4 million. The work session doesn't have audience questions. Sorry, that's why the beginning is. Ms. Dorn? Make sure you use the mic also, so the camera gets the thank you.
If we approve all of the AIP requests in this for the in the statement of needs, will that what will the gap then be for the AIP moving forward? Will it be 70% funded, 80% funded, 100% funded?
One of the things, go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. The only things that will remain are about $645,000. The $1,500 stipend is about $300,000 of that. A couple of other professional development assessment tools, but that it's only about $600,000. So we'll do that math. But,
I apologize. I want to go back to we went over these possible scenarios with TSAC, which is Teacher Staff Advisory Council. I will tell you I got more reaction to this. Just so you know that I want to be transparent what I'm trying to influence, but I thought you should know that. I meet once quarterly with that group, just so you have that information in front of you. And I think Ms. Hare was there. Where's Ms. Hare? You can't talk, but if you tell me, nod your head if I misinterpret it, or, okay, thank you.
So the reaction was positive?
The reaction to this was positive, as this being the option to, as the most favorable option, with the understanding that what we said is, it's not only giving them advice, and it would help us, because some of them are antiquated, and we just have not had the capacity to make sure that we give the basic tool for technology. Remember, they do their grades also, and all types of things with SIS and attendance and referrals. So we would create a consistent standard platform of what our teachers are issued. But this also, we were talking about, if we did this, also keep the current days except for the one, because we gotta have a built-in day for when there's upgrades or when there needs to train them on something new coming in as software. But we would also try to use part of the money to purchase or make a more robust online system So there's PD and pajamas, meaning there's certain things. One of the challenges that we have is, some teachers talked about, when you look on the thread, money to go to conferences. Well, conference average cost is $2,500 at minimum starting. So that doesn't spread to a whole lot of people. But the key is, are you creating systemic change or individual change? Because what happens if they come back, what's the mechanism for making sure that everybody gets that benefit of that resource or training that they've got? The courses that people talk about. Well, honestly, that has gotten research mixed bags. Sometimes a course is meaningful, sometimes courses are taken just to grow on a salary schedule, and sometimes courses are just courses that are with individual interests. So that would have to have a lot of robust work around it with regards to what type of courses and what are the choices that would be approved for it to be meaningful. No matter what, to create systemic change, you gotta have some parameters when you create choice to make sure that the things that are, if you look at the school's SPP, all the schools were supposed to identify what is their professional development focus based on their data and their weaknesses that they show from their data and their school. All of the schools have school climate sections. So any choice that's made has got to have, it has pros and cons, is my point. But this is the one that got the most favorable response from that group of people that came. I understand that a work session doesn't have audience questions. So I don't know if there's a process that they need to change their rules of. So your legal counsel.
Dr. Bitt, we have board consensus to open up the work session for comments and questions to 7:45. So, Dr. Fitt, we can complete presentation and then allow time for questions and comments.
So, Mr. Myers, will load the spreadsheet for you all to make your decisions and things you're considering. Obviously, if you have an item that you want to have more feedback on, you can table that, make a decision. They compile a spreadsheet that we've done in the past that allows you, when you say yes or no, it subtracts and tallies so you can see the numbers changing of what the number is that you are potentially going to consider sending forward at the next meeting. Did that make sense to everybody?
Give us just a second. We're going to put up some information that I think will be familiar with the last work session.
I
Thank you all for your patience. So we are going to add additional 15 minutes for public comment. And we will ask that you come forward, state your name, sign in, and you are limited to 1 minute. And if you have a question, the staff will hopefully answer the question to the best of their ability. If not, we will get back to you with the response.
Hello, Superintendent Bedden and the new school board. Thank you so much for being here. I'm happy to be here. This is my first time. I work as an inclusion preschool teacher with Head Start students at our new MLK school. And one of my biggest concerns is
Please state your name.
Oh, my name is Emily Walker. One of my biggest concerns is that of the 7 students on my caseload, 6 of them are really, really thriving in an inclusive environment in preschool. They're learning from their peers. They are excelling in PALS. We've seen huge, huge, huge success socially, behaviorally, academically. But the schools that they're going into for kindergarten do not provide inclusion as an option. I'm talking about Fairfield and Woodville and George Mason and the other schools in the East End. They don't really provide an inclusion option. And what I mean by that is co-teaching collaboration. I don't mean that they are removed from the classroom for certain periods, which is what's happening now, or there's some kind of push-in services. I'm talking about co-teaching. And you know, I can say that 20 years ago when I was in kindergarten, we had inclusion in kindergarten, first grade, second grade, third grade, fourth grade, all the way up. At least one classroom provided that. Now, if it's that we need more teachers, and more teachers in the East End, you know, who teach special education inclusion, then that's something that we really need to focus our budget on, because right now we are seeing these kids who are over age in first grade, second grade, third grade. That would be eliminated if we had another teacher to provide the services that are written into their IEP, and so that we will not have these compliance issues that we've been having. Thank you.
Tom Hartman speaking as an individual. I understand the administration to be saying that the state requires school districts to have 200 days. I've been furiously trying to find that in the Code of Virginia. I have not. When this issue came up a couple of years ago, I believe I found that that was the maximum. It seems to be clear from
30 seconds.
Clear from what I have found that 180 days is the minimum. It was also the case when the issue came up, we were provided with a number of other districts. There was not a single district doing 200 days. I do not believe it's required by the state. If it is, I'd like to see that documented.
Virginia Code 22.1302, and we presented that when we presented the budget originally. A written contract is in the form permitted by the Board of Education regulations and blah, 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 but it gets to the standard 10-month contract shall include 200 days. Shall include 200 days with a minimum of 180 teaching days. So it's teaching days is the minimum. And or 990 instructional hours, and up to 20 days of activities such as teaching, participating in professional development, planning, evaluating, completing records, and reports, participating on committees or in conferences, or such other activities as may be assigned or approved by the local school.
Good evening. I'm just coming to share some additional information. First, thank you so much for sharing your feedback. And we are excited to hear that the majority of the students are being successful. Just wanted to make sure that all staff were aware that while some feeder schools, for example, the K schools that those pre-K students are zoned for now may not currently have those services in place, we provide staffing based on the services written into students' IEPs. So if for your students, if you believe and the IEP team believes when you review that IEP, whether it's coming up next week, next month, that the most appropriate, least restrictive environment for those students is a co-taught class, which as in Virginia is defined by two professionals in the classroom providing instruction together, then those are the services that you should write to the IEP. And it is then my job and the Director of Special Education to make sure that the appropriate staffing is put in place to support those students. So please don't make sure that your colleagues know. We don't want them to be constrained by what they see is currently, because those services currently in those schools are based on what's written in those students' IEPs that are currently at those settings. But if your students need something different, please write the services based on those students' needs, and then it's our job to figure out the staffing component. But again, thank you so much for your comments and your feedback.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Sarah Bird. I'm over at William Fox Elementary with a low-incidence autism classroom. I'm actually here to respond a little bit to what Dr. Boyd was saying, and I do appreciate you addressing us on the special education. I know that's a big issue for a lot of families in the community. As it is now, we would love to set up IEPs the way that we believe the student would most benefit from them, but we are being told by administration at our meetings that these services are not already available to them
at schools
that they're available to get to within their zones. We cannot write it in there that we are to offer what is more convenient than what is best for the child. I have multiple coworkers that can attest to that. I know that that's not supposed to be how it is because we've tried to address that, but we are limited in our capacity to do that.
And I won't be too hard, but just so that anyone knows, if there's any questions or you feel like you're being asked, I will listen to
you. I tried to use my teacher voice, but that wasn't sufficient. Thank you. Let me say this, that there are a number of supports. So if you ever feel like you're a staff person and you're being asked to do something that is not in accordance to what our regulations are or to what we've told you to do, for example, we all know, and I'm so glad that you all are aware, that we write IEPs based on students' needs, yes?
Yes.
I know we're not going to be back and forth, but I just want to make sure. So with that, please make sure that you reach out to your instructional specialist. You can send me an email, you can give me a call, because we'll have those follow-up conversations and make sure that people are aware. I don't want cookie-cutter IEPs. I don't want kids being fit into what's existing. Again, as we said, we make services and we provide supports based on what students need, not the other way around. So I'm here if you ever need me, M. Boyd, and 780-7911. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Boyd. Also, I'm excited to remind everyone, if you have a question or comment, please let it be related to the budget. And you providing your question or comments will help the board make an informed decision. So thank you.
Jenny Gomo, PTA President for John B. Carey. I was asked to shed a little bit of our teachers' concerns as far as the PD goes. And I've actually been able to kind of oversee, be able to see what's going on too. I think our teachers are concerned that they don't
pertain to them. The EPDs, they're all grouped into one lump, and they're not individualized between like our teacher, why is she having to go to this math or something like that. So that's
30 seconds.
One of those things. And then they don't have enough time in their classroom. I was told to tell you that they don't have enough time in their classroom. And what else? They're gonna kill me. That's it. I personally think the laptop idea is really good, but that's it.
Hi, Susan Ammon, and I just need a clarification regarding the standards of quality or standards of education that you cited regarding the number of teacher days. You cited that for a 10-month contract. We've always had a 9.5-month contract, so a 9.5-month contract was not 200 days, so I think that that's part of the issue, that we've gone from a 9.5-month teaching contract to what we're citing is a 10-month teaching contract, and I do believe there are different lines for that, recognizing, of course, that it is the pleasure of the board that we do the number of days you address, but there are differences, I believe, between a 9.5-month, a 10-month, 11, and a 12-month contract. Thank you.
So please recall, as I stated, that one of the things that happens to you when you're at a number of schools that are school improvement, you get reviewed by the state, they find that you're not doing things in compliance. There's no such thing as a 9.5-month contract in Virginia. The language says a standard contract shall be a 10-month contract, as I just read it verbatim. So we had to move to comply with it. Now, what your colleague just said is true. It's all over the board in what people are doing, but at the end of the day, when something is found out that you're not adhering to, I have a responsibility based on my certification and my oath to the Commonwealth to adhere to the code. And when they looked at and saw that we weren't following the code, for me to not follow the code would jeopardize my license. The language says standard is a 10-month contract, 200 day. But he was right about when you survey other people, they're all over the board in what they're doing. But we are under a microscope. In fact, on March 17th, I think, we are going through a division level review. March 6th, the week of it, where they will look at our human resources practices, our academic practices, our support service and operations, our communication, all of that they're gonna go through in the district. Now, we requested it and wanted it because we wanna get better, but they're gonna look at our human resource practices also.
We just would like to thank everyone for coming out, providing their input, and I think it's very important for this board to exercise transparency, and it's very valuable that we receive your input as teachers, community members. So again, just want to say thank you. And we will continue with the work session.
Thank you, Madam Chairman and Board. I'd like to continue our discussion from last week. I want to start here. We had sent to the Board some very detailed explanations of the items that were included in the Superintendent's Estimate of Needs, and we began our discussions from this document. We put another copy of this up at the board settings, and I hope that you have them. If not, we certainly have more. So just to put a frame of where we're going to pick back up, we're going to work from this document. But there were some items that we said that the board reached consensus regarding moving forward and requesting funding. There were some that we said that we thought that we could identify ways, primarily through attrition savings, to help ourselves. And then finally, there was going to be a discussion tonight about the remaining items, whether the board would like to move forward and request funding or not. So the first one I'd like to put up is the one that we feel that the board reached consensus last week. We should be able to move through that quickly. We talked about the commitments that the school board has made with regard to the second year of the teacher decompression, and I believe it was consensus for that. I can go down a little bit. We also talked in some detail about the 2.5% adjustment for the folks that are on the unified scale, not on the teacher scale, and this was to try to bring them up to the cost of living increase, the shortfall in the cost of living increase over the last 2 years. We talked about nurses, and we had a pretty extended discussion about the fact that they were on a 10-month contract. Just a little bit more. And then these items, which as we go a little further in the budget process, we're going to talk about our structural, our balance of efficiency with regard to transportation. We are also structurally out of balance with these items. So if we include these more funding in our budget, that would ease some of the stress that we have to use our turnover, and we can talk about how all of that flows through the budget if that pleases the board tonight. But we talked about the need to include these are existing services that we're already delivering, and we have to find other savings, primarily through vacancy savings. We believe the board agreed to that. A total of $13.6 million. Does that sound like everybody's remembrance? Great. I'm going to jump to the items that I'd like to talk through tonight to see if the board will reach some consensus about the others. Yes, ma'am.
A couple of us had a side conversation during the break, so I thought I would bring it up here to see if we agree with this process. That I think we should continue to discuss the things that we haven't discussed in that we didn't already look at last time. But then I would suggest that potentially we email Dawn and Patrick after this with any items that we still feel uncomfortable with. And to the extent that there is more than one of us that feels that way, we can use the subject or the time at the next work session to hash out the remaining items that we still are sort of not receiving each other.
What you'll see, these are the remaining, and most of these are larger. We're going to talk about the academic improvement plan, middle school athletics, the multicultural center, the need for expanded language teachers. So what we've tried to put together is, here are the items, here are the costs and the people, and over here, if you decide you want to go forward, we'll put up a running total of what you guys are supportive, and the ones that we still want to have some more discussion. And of course, if we have some additional
explanation that's needed as we go through these, we'll ask the folks to come up and have some open dialogue. The first one we had, and we can start with any of these you like, I'm just working down the list as it was presented. We talked a lot about the multicultural center that is in place today. This is the expansion of the multicultural center, and the need is because we are seeing so many families that are coming into Richmond that are not from not native to our country, and English is not their first language. So we can certainly talk about each of these positions: counselor, the office person, the data process processing data entering person, and the need for another interpreter. But this is the first grouping that I think we'd like to talk about. If you're not prepared to talk about these tonight, we can postpone. Or if you have additional questions, we'll certainly ask our instruction folks to come up.
Just out of curiosity, which month do we not need the interpreter and the counselor?
As I'm certain you know, all of our 11-month contracts are off during July.
So our intention when we planned the Multicultural Service Center was to be open during those July and August months to get those late registrations. And so we would have to look at our schedule. We've had a lot of, again, we planned on this month being a down month, but we've had a total of the last week, 31 new families to come in. So as we're anticipating having a lapse, the families just keep coming and keep coming, and we want to make sure we're able to support them. But certainly some months are higher than others. And so, for example, if we were to say that month at the end of June, beginning of July is a slow month, we may be able to support those families at the school with some other resources that we have. But July and August, the latter part of July and August are always high moments, not only just for our families that don't speak English, but for other families who are relocating or who have just simply forgot to register, for example, during kindergarten registration and are coming in to the school. And we want to make sure that those schedules are prepared, because we know the scheduling is a huge piece, particularly at the secondary level, and we want to make sure that all of those things are ironed out.
So you're saying mid-June to mid-July, they would not be working?
Potentially, and we're just going to continue to look at those trends, because again, our previous projection was that we would have some other slumps that we could potentially scale back the center, but our enrollment just has not reflected that. And so we're, again, growing and understanding the transition a little bit better.
Thank you.
Thank you.
As I know that you're aware, the difference in 11 and 12 months is about an 8%, but also the 12-month employee also earns leave that the 11-month employee doesn't. So when you take that into account, there's not a huge difference in the number of work days in an 11-month and 12-month. So again, depending on how the board would like to go forward tonight, we would look for consensus about whether you're supportive of moving this forward in your school board approved budget, or if we still want some additional discussion.
I think the multicultural, I think we definitely, the numbers are clear. We definitely need to have services for our non-English speaking families. I know that there have been conversations with the city about coordinating between our multicultural center and their multicultural center. I still have concerns that we are creating two separate places for our families to go to, and I still don't really understand why those aren't one and the same. So I'd just like to talk that through. And then additionally, there's another line item for another interpreter through FACE. That to me seems redundant with the interpreter with the multicultural center, and I'm just wondering why aren't we focused on making sure that our FACE counselors are also attending to our multicultural needs, and I just want to make sure that we're not duplicating resources.
Yes, ma'am. I'm only going to address the budget line item for the FACE interpreter. That's the company that we pay, the folks, the guys that come up here at the beginning of the meeting. We are under budget. That's a budget correction. So it's not addressing the coordination between the city and others. That simply is a budget correction, that particular line.
Thank you, Mr. Myers. And we certainly are in communication with the city, but we want to make sure that the coursework pieces that are a little bit more unique to education, we have those things
plotted out. Oftentimes when families come, there takes a lot of legwork figuring out where they were, where to place them educationally. And so as the conversations evolve, we may find that we may be able to unite and have a firm educational piece as long with the city supports, which is why we actually located the Multicultural Center, Service Center in the Southside Plaza. So that's not out of discussion, but right now we need to make sure that we're still forging ahead so that we remain compliant with our OCR resolution. But certainly if there's down the road, if we're able to merge and be more efficient with both little funds, that would be ideal.
I guess, but then that begs the question, do we really need an office associate? Because if we merge with the city, then we probably wouldn't need two office associates for one center.
And so this person, if you look at the office associate, as well as the, as well as our SIS operator, those persons, so the persons who support the center, we're looking for a lot of people to wear multiple hats. So where you see the counselor, we're trying to seek a bilingual counselor, different things like that. So this won't just necessarily be when you think of a clerical staff in some locations of answering the phone, scheduling meetings. Hopefully these people will be able to assist with some administrative tasks otherwise to make this office flow more cleanly with the number of families and the supports that we need there. So it's going to be a little bit more unique job description that you would see perhaps at a comprehensive school and things of that nature.
We would be out of compliance if we merged with the city because the purpose is not what our OCR complaint said.
Good evening. I also wanted to add that I am working with the Multicultural Affairs Office, specifically Carla Mercer, and they have a different mission than our particular center, and so we are trying to collaborate where we can. But as of right now, but they are functioning on advocacy for the general population, and they do not they are not heavily staffed. They have Carla and two interpreters that support with other public community needs that support those kinds of missions. In terms of what we have to do to be compliant with our OCR and our legal mandates, require someone that can actually interpret educational documents, support families on multiple levels, school-based kind of activities. So we have talked and we are trying to combine where we can, but because our missions are running parallel, but not the same, we haven't been able to come quite together to the degree that you're talking about.
So if it pleases the board, we can continue to work through. We're not ready to make a decision tonight.
The OCR complaint that's been referenced, are we under an agreement? Is that what we would be out of compliance with, or has somebody just filed an OCR complaint? We are trying to address the issues.
So no, we have, the OCR complaint was received a year and a half, 2 years ago. We actually did a voluntary resolution where we outlined that we would commit to doing certain things, i.e. not using staff or interpreting, i.e. making sure that services were available to families at discipline meetings and our primary language IEP meetings, a number of things that we resolved to do to ensure that our families whose primary language is not English, to ensure that those families have the same access to be able to support their students that English-speaking families have.
So I just wonder, and I know we're talking about a relatively small amount of money in our overall budget, but whether or not there's a way to comply with what we agreed to, but also partner with the city. So if those are our employees and they're doing our stuff, does it matter whether it's we're sharing somebody who says, oh, you're here for social services or you're here for X, you go to this place, oh, I'm here to register my kid, you go here. Do those things matter enough that we would be, quote unquote, out of compliance or paying again if we're having a counselor and you know what I mean? Like, as long as the kids are getting the services that we've agreed to give them through this voluntary resolution, because I think addressing these issues is critically important. But I just wonder whether or not we can say we're willing to invest whatever the total is and then, you know, direct you all to figure out a way to maximize those resources in conjunction with the city and keep us in compliance with the voluntary resolution.
So in the resolution that we listed, we don't list out we're going to fund X number of FTEs. So I just want to make sure we're being very transparent with that. But we do indicate that we're going to have certain things in place. As Ms. Jones said before, and as I tried to share a little bit earlier, our clerical person is not just wouldn't just be a receptionist, if you will. They would also be assisting in getting the kids scheduled, getting them assisted with testing, the access, all those different things that they need so that we can appropriately place and schedule those students. Not sure how that will certainly align with what the city is doing, which is why we kind of shared earlier that we want to make sure that we're in compliance. We don't want to have to hang our hat on a what if down the line because it's not laid out that way currently. So we would be remiss to say without any assurance that yes, we could do X right now with the city and still be in compliance. Because we can't say that with full confidence, we're bringing forward these things that we believe we need to have in place to fully comply with the resolution as it stands presently. But notwithstanding us trying, we're always trying to look at how we can further maximize our support. So we've looked at, we've weighed, bringing in interpreters. So for the line that was referenced earlier, the contracted services for phase one, just as interpreters, we do a lot of contracting out, but we're also trying to look at, would it be more beneficial to hire an interpreter to have some additional folks on the RPS payroll that we can send out wherever so you're not paying hourly $25, $35 an hour to come and do introductions here because we pay a certain minimum fee even if there's no one being supported here. Those type of things, if we have somebody on roll, we're just paying a salary. So we're trying to look at a multiple options, but with the city piece, I just couldn't give you a definitive yes and say we would still be in compliance at this point.
So I understand our approach here that we need to budget based on what our needs and our responsibilities are to these students. I think something, just to see clarification here, if we do find a way to better partner with the city, I assume that we can make use of those efficiencies at some point and make a budget transfer should we need to.
And I don't want to speak out of turn, but we're still continuing to have those conversations, as Ms. Jones said. Right now, we just haven't arrived yet, but certainly if there was a way that the city said, we'll give you X, this is going to mutually serve both organizations, we can share this FTE or we'll even fund this FTE, that would certainly be ideal. We would definitely inform you all of that should it arise. So we're not saying that we're closing the door, we're not seeking any other opportunities at this time, but just based on the information that we have at this very moment, this is just where we are. But it's an ongoing discussion. So to Mr. Bourne's point, it's not a closed door, but it's just, we just haven't gotten all the details out right now.
Thanks.
I just wanted to respond a little bit about budget process with that, and thank you for bringing that up. We have a long way to go in this process, as you all know. We have many, many more meetings that will set priorities. We'll talk about where we think we can reallocate funds. So as we get a little further with our discussions with the mayor and city council, and we have more of a reality check with regard to what the realizable funding is, we'll come back several times to what our highest priorities are. So thank you for bringing that up. Yes, at this moment, we're trying to put a framework together of what we are supportive of and what we are willing to advocate for funding versus what we aren't. And that's what we're trying to do today, is to get you very comfortable that as you go out to the public, that you are able to say why we need these things and explain them. And if you aren't, then we haven't done our job. So we certainly can decide on consensus, or we can move forward. I know this seems laborious. There really are only four other items to talk about to get through this list. To move forward for right now, or
mean, I would only say let's just keep an open mind to continuing to work with the city, and not take, well, they have different missions as no, as a no, or that it's, you know, let's say yes until we really can't say no anymore.
Okay. So just so there's a visual, if you would just put a yes for right now. What we're, just so we all see what we're agreeing to. Do we want to put a yes on these things, or we don't want to put anything in there right now? These four. Okay, great. Okay, we also talked about the need for expanding to move forward, to kind of see how we're trying to work through this tonight. The expansion of Spanish, American Sign Language, and Mandarin. Mandarin, of course, being the more gifted with Chimborazo, Brown, and TJ. We talked about the need for five additional Spanish and American Sign Language and two gifted Mandarin teachers. I'm going to hold on Bannon course, a similar discussion, but slightly different, and see if there's any additional questions. Okay, so we'll put yes on those two. Okay. And Bannon course, Dr. Bedden certainly did an excellent job of talking about trying to prepare our students so they would, okay, I'm seeing a yes. Okay. Can we scroll down so we can take a look at middle school athletics? I certainly don't want to talk about all of these instructional items. However, I was in the meeting when we met with the city last week to see if there was a way to partner with them. They have a pretty active youth football league. It's, I believe they said they have 20 leagues and they play at 17 fields. They do not have 15-year-olds, but they do have a 13 and 14-year-old program, and I think they cited that right now they have over 600 participants. So we tried a lot of different angles to see how we could partner. We didn't get there, but they have funding that the city puts in place, not only for equipment and coach for equipment and referees, but for coaches, also for coordinators. So I don't want to speak for Dr. Bedden or Dr. Kane. What we had originally put together was to try to build our program, and that still may be the path, is to get students, children, connected to their school and to their feeder pattern, as opposed to a youth athletic league that may not specifically be to their middle and high school path. That may still be where we want to go. I did want to tell you that we're continuing to explore every avenue that we can to try to make this connection for our children.
Certainly we support the concept of the middle school athletics. Could you elaborate a little more about how two trainers can support the entire middle school athletics program?
I couldn't hear part of your question. Could we elaborate on how two trainers could
support the entire middle school athletics program? What would their roles be, trainers?
So they are working with students in preparing them for athletic events. They also work with them, and Dr. Bedden probably wants to jump in here, but they also work with them if there is an injury. They are very instrumental for that, and you know, concussion awareness is huge right now, as it should be. So their role is really, it's integral. I mean, you can't have an athletic program without
them. Now, I understand the need for trainers, but how would two support all of middle schools?
So we don't have a lot of students. Every student wouldn't play. So if we've got 5,000 middle school students, then certainly 9 times out of 10, 5,000 students wouldn't play. Dr. Beck?
What you see is in addition to what we do already. So all of the sports we already have in existence. The idea is that if we're going to add a high impact sport like football, we needed to actually make sure we have trainers available to cover those events. So we actually offer sports already. It wasn't about adding them to cover all athletics. It was because we just added a high impact sport because we don't have those training positions now. So we would continue to do what we do now, make sure the high impact sports cover, and then also deploy them where time is available to support other sports. But this is in addition to what we do now. Our concern was when you add that high impact, you gotta make sure you have available resources to support the high impact sport guaranteed. Does that make sense?
The other middle school sports, we have soccer, we have flag football, we do girls cheerleading, we have basketball, we have tennis. Yeah, just it's new.
And what's the average participation?
That information is in your report, it's in your folders. I don't have it committed to memory, but it is in your folders in the Google Drive.
Getting back to the athletic trainers, currently we have a trainer at each high school, correct?
Correct.
Correct.
Right. So you're saying that these are two additional positions will support the middle school athletics or?
Right. So we don't have to have a personal trainer for basketball, and we don't have to have a personal trainer for soccer or flag football. But the idea is because this is a high contact sport, this is different from what we have happening in middle schools right now.
So another comment. So if there's support for middle school athletics, is also the understanding that we are going to improve and enhance our high school athletics as well?
When you say improve, this is being done because one of the issues we've noticed is we don't have feeder pattern. Our high school programs, if you look at the scores, you look at the numbers, they're very low. And for me, as a person who's a former AD, central office AD, and a former coach, it's disheartening every time I look at paper on Saturday and see what our children are going through. So we really don't have a true feeder and development pattern to prepare them. So the idea is that this will help create a feeder pattern for those high schools.
Right.
We have the same situation that we just launched recently because girls volleyball didn't start too long ago for us, but the numbers have been low there also. So the idea is both from a standpoint of equity opportunity, we had girls volleyball at middle school and with the intent of trying to grow interest for those young ladies to continue to go ahead and play. The idea was that we could add to the numbers for cheerleading opportunity because, you know, football, if we get the numbers we hope to get, is a large number typically of guys, but we wanted to make sure we had a large number of opportunities for our girls to have some opportunity. We're not trying to do away with the flag football or the soccer. Obviously that they could have been impacted if someone ships over, but our goal is not to take away, this is the add to. But it's also meant to be another extended day opportunity for our children. For our middle school children, to give them other options to be at school and doing things where they don't. We've had some conversations about the pros and cons of what exists with the Parks and Rec. That has had some interesting dialogue and conversations. As you know, Mrs. Page, we've had conversations. We've already started the conversation of reviewing our current structure with Mr. Safini with athletics. One of the things we uncovered is that when you look at the current job description of the instructional specialist, it doesn't say anything about having to run athletics anymore. Her job is an instructional specialist, and that seems to be an add-on. As of now, right now, we're researching, but we're told that other than Hanover, the other districts don't roll that position into. We're looking at the issue that our ADs at the school don't really report. She has no authority over them. They report to the principal. So whether that's the most effective model to have in place for athletics. She should, whoever's in that spot when we run it, should be the true program administrator, even if it's not direct supervision of those people, but be the ultimate first clearinghouse to say that the checks and balances with eligibility, they should be the person who assures that they're adhering to the board policies with GPAs and our internal, because our requirement is higher than VHSL. Of course, the middle school VHSL doesn't have any say, so we totally are standards that we put in place for competition. The idea is to create our own middle, possibly our own middle school league, you know, from middle school to middle school, whatever, to try to get our kids to play with each other. Where possible, if there's another chance to incorporate others, we would, but the main goal is to foster that developmental field pattern for our high school programs.
Okay, so middle school athletics, and that's to create a feeder program strengthening high school. Are there any thoughts or do we need additional funding for high school athletics?
Well, the answer is in generally, yes. I mean, that's from, if nothing else, from a facility standpoint. But you know, we put a line item that says $160,000, just like we did with band and performing arts, that each school, high school, would have the rotation of $100,000 investment, then off years $15,000. So again, we had to start somewhere in creating a dedicated line item. Because there's so many huge deficits that exist at the level that we had to start somewhere. The same way we were able to refurbish our, if you saw some of our band equipment and uniforms, that was started with the same model of $160,000 investment, and then as the economics improve, we can grow the investment. But on the capital side, that's huge. And Tommy, pretty good. Was there money in the capital for any of that? No, but athletics in general, was there any? Yeah, your point, yeah, we got major challenges. I mean, I will tell you that when I talk to students and parents, our facilities, one of the main reasons they also leave us also.
Student information, and Mr. Jefferson certainly talked about the details. We talked about this at our last work session.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the school board. The reason this item is on here is because when we first came to the division, and our current operation has office associates who are basically on paper. Every school has 1, 2, 3 office associates. One of those office associates is currently designated to be the person who handles all student information, inputs the information into the student our Aspen system. So they do all that work, but they are the same level as any other office assistant, person that answers the phone, person that would take care of students and other needs of the school. We have a great need for dedicated student information operators. That's why this was put in the budget as a proposal for last year. What we did was did the detailed analysis. ICTIS went around and along with HR, we did a detailed analysis of the current number of office associates in each school by the number of students. This would be a new position that would be created. So people would actually apply for the position, and we would use, it was 10 FTEs, but each of the secondary schools, that's what we started with, would have a full-time system student information operator. This work is critical for building master schedules, for making sure the transcripts are accurate, and making sure that the school counselors are getting the right information that they need, and that the information school counselors are putting in is properly vetted and everything lines up and matches, that the numbers for course sections work, the numbers for staffing, all those things work. And currently, we're relying on people who really have minimal training to do this work. And so this is a great need for the division to get this fixed. If this was approved, we have a process. We went and did all the work and laid it out last year. We would relaunch that work to post the positions, to conduct interviews, and have these people ready to start in July. But it would be, it's a fundamental shift of the work that's being done to make sure we have a professional in our buildings at the secondary schools who is able to do all this work and do it properly. That's why we request it.
The number of office associates varies depending upon the school, correct?
That's correct.
Most have two, or most have one?
So I'd say probably you have one, so your open community, Franklin, they would have one, and a lot of them have two, some have three, four.
And so I just wonder whether or not we can find 10 current positions of those office associates or train them to be these data folks. I don't know whether or not they are so busy that we actually need the 10 additional positions, or can we reconfigure 10 that we already have.
So the nice, another great selling point of this particular budget item would be that we're actually going to be, the analysis was how many currently office associates does this building have? It has two. You know what, this building has two, a building just like it has three, why does this one have two? What we need to do is we can make this work by taking the three that are in one building, okay, one of those will be a designated system operator, and then the other school will then pick up a new system operator. So that's exactly what the plan would be, is that hopefully the talent will be within the division now, that some of those folks will apply for those positions and meet the qualifications of those positions. Now these qualifications would be considerably different than a lot of these people may be used to. But that's part of the work. But that's why it's in position.
Just really quickly to piggyback on that, your comments about potentially moving some existing employees into those positions. One of the major concerns is that they have the appropriate skill sets to be able to move into those roles. And so this job will be specifically posted and designed to attract someone who already has those skill sets. There's a concern that our existing office associates don't have the technology background to be able to function in a role like this.
Certainly, I understand there's a different skill set. I would just venture to say, or I would hope that we could train some of them and give them those skills. But so I was just trying to figure out whether or not we already have people sitting in seats that we could reclassify, or say instead of office associate one, you are now going to be a SysOp data entry person or student information person. Because the volume of office associate work is such that we only need one, we already have a position in school. So that's really the basis of my question.
And that's how we did an analysis, actually all the jobs are done in every building, sort of attendance, tracking, every job is done by office associates. We looked at that, and then we said, and if we dedicate a person to being full-time student information system operator, how would this break out? We would welcome any of those people in those seats, certainly would be able to apply for these positions, and if they have the skills, certainly they could get in that position. But they would lose a job. So if I'm an office associate right now, I'm not going to lose my position, but I may not be at that school. There'd be a lot of moving parts.
And also understanding that it would be a different pay grade than the existing office associate. It doesn't align one-to-one.
Work is being done poorly now, yes.
Poorly defined. With training, how or is it just that we just need to start?
You got people that don't know how to use Excel that are using this program. Yeah. It's a very user interface program. There's lots of challenges in it, so it is a very different mindset as to a database driven set. So, yeah, people can be trained, absolutely, and people are using Aspen and putting the information in. It is being done, but we continue to find errors. It takes a lot of background. Piece that's hard to, and we can put all the documents together, you can see exactly how, what all the numbers we looked at, and I can certainly get that to you. When you look at all the tasks that have to be done in our schools, especially in schools with one office associate, for instance, you're asking to do phone calls, attendance, daily absences for faculty and staff, hourly reporting, so they have a tremendous amount of jobs. So they really need to have two people, we'd say, in that job. But if you bring the second person in, it would make, we need a person also who's in charge of making sure the transcripts are correct, make sure that student schedules, that as students come in to register and they meet with the counselor, that all the information be keyed in accurately, and that we can take a load off the school counselor for doing some of that manual entry of student information so that the counselors can do more of the work that they need to do. So there's lots of benefits to this, and the reason it's 10 and not 17 or 18 is because we looked at the efficiencies of how do we best operate the administrative needs that our buildings have. And we started at the secondary level. Everyone does get training. And we send those folks in, they'll sit down with the experts. We've had asthma for 2 years. Those people that are currently touching that system, they do get training and they're trained on it. But there's a difference between I can enter in 1, 2, 3, 4 and know that pops up and says that's an algebra class versus, oh, here's a student, a rising ninth grader. I share lots of information with the counselors. I'm able to put this student in to see the big picture and run that transcript and kind of double check and make sure things are being done properly. So it's a very important position for schools, and we don't have those right now. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Myers.
Want to move forward?
Yes.
Okay.
But I think we would like to table discussion for the student information systems operators.
Yes, ma'am. As promised, there's only two more items. One, you'll see the foreign language in the elementary schools. These are 26 part-time people. The services we're already providing. Just like we did with our exceptional ed services and transportation, these are costs we're already incurring. If you approve this and the funding becomes available, this continues to take the stress off of our turnover savings, which again, we still have a transportation issue that we need to talk about down the road. So this will help our overall budget by fixing another structural problem. Great, thank you. Yes. And then the last one, if you put the whole AIP up on the, no, scroll down, sorry. No, for consideration. Yeah. There we go. We talked about this a lot over the course of the last month or so. Certainly we talked about it a lot tonight. This is the $5.2 million request, and just to be crystal clear, it does include $3.4 million for professional development. Still, the decision about how and how much is ahead for the board, and a reminder, Dr. Bedden has presented four options for that.
You want to take it?
Yes, ma'am.
Professional development.
Oh, just the one item.
Yes.
But the other is at the pleasure of the board to move forward. Want to have some further discussion? Okay.
Hey, David, what's the per pupil cost for this program?
It'll be about $15,000 plus-ish per student. It is.
I guess my question with the overage under-accredited, I think you laid out a good case for why we need it, and speaking with a bunch of teachers that have overage students in their class, it's a big problem. And I think it's obviously growing, and because we have funded it, I'm in support of funding a portion of it. What I have a hard time with is that about $500,000 of the total $1.3 million request is going to teachers, and the rest is going to a principal, which I don't quite understand why we need a new principal for the program. So if you could just help me understand why we need a principal, a clerk, a social worker, a guidance counselor, all these other services that are not directly related to teaching. Because my understanding is the program is going to go into TJ, so.
Right. So, and I see Dr. Boyd coming up behind me, but essentially, she's going to get into more detail. But the nature of the needs of that group of students is so very significant that that's not a population that we can place into a school that's already functioning without additional administrative support. Not only administrative support, but that social-emotional support is significant as well. I'm going to stop talking because I know Dr. Boyd wants to say something, but that's a major point.
This is within the building, so it's obviously not a principal. It is a dean, it's a person administrator there to be in charge, someone who's able to perform, administrations has the license grants them the ability to act disciplinary with students, to evaluate the teachers. So there has to be someone there who can do that. When you already have a high school on top of that, the job would be quite a bit to add on to the principal of the building to say, we're going to add these other teachers into this program. So that's one of the reasons you have, it's not a principal, but there's, think of it as an assistant principal level, a dean level, the person that's going to be there. Also, these students have extremely high needs. Their backgrounds have been beyond understanding for a lot of us. What they've experienced has created lots of issues in their life that they can't just sit there. They have to have some adults that are going to interact with them in meaningful ways, not just with teaching. So that's why you have, this is a very top-heavy program, because you're going to have a counselor, psychologist, the social worker. You're going to have a team of people working with this relatively small number of students to try to change the direction that they've been moving in and shift it into a new direction. And so the movement in the high school will be successful. So yeah, it costs a lot of money.
And Ms. Page, if I might just add as well, with any new program, as Mr. Jeffers has shared, you have a unique student population. With any new initiative, you need to make sure that there's fidelity to implementation. And the last thing we want to have is to put the program in place in the school and the principal and the leadership not be able to effectively supervise, progress monitor, provide supports, because then those teachers become disenchanted. Then you have things like attrition and those type of things because they're not getting the appropriate administrative support, which is one of the key driver factors when we talk about teacher retention. The other pieces when we talked about, as Mr. Jeffers alluded, when we planned this program, we certainly did look at the research to say for this student population, students who are overage, students who historically have behavioral challenges, because that's coupled with a lot of our students who have attendance challenges, what type of programmatic supports need to be in place? What does that programming need to look like? And so that's why those social emotional supports are so critical. And I know some people may say, well, why do you need one whole mental health professional to work with 90 kids? Well, you're looking at 90 students, but when we look at our tiered supports, they're not those kids who are at tier one. We're just seeing a counselor, those universal supports, school rules and expectations have been successful. So a lot of these students will need to have small group counseling, individual counseling. Let's talk about how you get back on track. Let's talk about reframing the way you even think about school, the way your family thinks about school. So it's 90 students, but it's truly, truly intense time with both the students and their families on an ongoing basis so you can get a more positive connection with school and engagement with those persons. So that's why you look at that. And we want to make sure that it's successful. We know that we're going to have changes, but we just don't want to throw this as something else, as a lot of the teachers alluded to earlier. People don't want something else added on, and then they're not really bought into it.
So Dr. Boyd, is this program based on best practices? Is there another model that we are replicating?
Yes, ma'am. So we looked at a number of different models. I'm sorry.
I'm just saying, you know, evidence-based.
Yes, we've looked at a number of different models as the AIP team, Theme 5 or Team 5, and pulled from different aspects of programs. Some of them talk about transition programs. Some of them talk about online models. But we learned that for the online models, we didn't think that would be a good piece for our students because even though they're older, the maturity and attention to task, we even found with some of our high school students, we have to redirect. And we want this group of students to be able to transition back into a comprehensive school. So you build that piece in too, which is why we didn't think an online model, which is another noted model for credit recovery. But because they have to go back to a comprehensive setting, they need to be able to be in instruction and engage and working with peers and things like that, which is vastly different than Aspire, which is not a transitionary program.
So what school district, did you all model?
So it's not necessarily a school district. It's different research-based elements, and we can share with you the research components that are important for successful programs and changing academic outcomes for students, which would be our target population, and we can share that information with the board. So in short, we just didn't pull it out of the air.
There is an online component because you have 433,000, and then you also put in 500,000 towards the program.
Yes, ma'am. So if you look at some of the components, we're going to have, it says four core teachers. So we wanted to have a reading specialist, a math specialist, a math teacher, and an English teacher. The reading specialist and math specialist specifically, because they need to be able to diagnose those areas of deficiency and being able to remediate those areas. That's vastly different than what an English teacher at the secondary level will be able to do. We're talking about teaching reading as opposed to teaching literature comprehension that you would do at secondary level. So, but some of the things like the history courses will only have, when you look at the program outline, I believe it's middle school, with the seventh grade would take social studies, and so that's only 30 students, so instead of trying to get a full FTE, how will we potentially use online options and or looking at the staffing that's at TJ, if the staffing is low, then we might be able to share a position. So again, going back to those efficiencies that Mr. Bourne spoke about earlier, we're certainly trying to exhaust as many options as possible. And so that might be a higher number. That number might actually come in lower, but just looking at our individual student needs and what they are, where they are with their coursework.
So, Dr. Boyd, based on the information that's being presented,
I think it's not a question per se, but a comment. Because we have several alternative programs. We have the Aspire program. I'm looking at the data in terms of the kids who are enrolled, on average, 40 some kids, but the kids who actually show up, less than half. So then I automatically start thinking about the effectiveness of that program. And we are paying around $800,000. I'm going to Aspire, but I'm just to make a point to this. Around $800,000 for a program whereas we are targeting around 40 kids. And and only half of those kids are attending, but not even half of the kids are attending all of the time. Just based on this data, I looked at 19 days, and out of the 19 days, you had 8 days where 50% where kids were attending, 50% and more. And those who attended over 60% and more, just 2 days. So this is my concern as we move forward. Just how do we're in the second year of Aspire. We may push this another alternative program forward, and I just want to make sure that however we devise it, whatever it's going to look like, that it is effective, and that we continue to monitor and make quick adjustments. Because we're saying that we have 90 kids who really need this, and the goal is to get them to high school. And I don't want it to be like what I'm seeing with Aspire. That's my comment. I want to make sure the kids are indeed being serviced.
To piggyback on that, could you just briefly distinguish between the students who are in Aspire and these kids?
Sure. So Aspire is a high school program. It's for overage high school students. The students who are at Aspire have previously at one time or another been in a comprehensive high school. Those students may have academic, maybe overage for their grade level or under-accredited, so are behind significantly, and typically it's not just 1 year. Those students may have had behavioral challenges, and those students also and or have had significant attendance challenges. Those students that are there also may have had some engagement with court involvement or probationary involvement. This program is not a transition program in that the students, once they're placed at Aspire, that's where they will complete their academic career. It again also has the social emotional supports because like the middle school population, the number of those students, as I said, have the social emotional challenges and trying to work with those families. Aspire is a half-day program, so students either come for an AM session or a PM session, and that was designed for some of our students who are parents, for some of our students who, based on their economic circumstances, work a lot of hours to support the families, and I'm not just talking about buying an extra pair of errands, truly supporting the household. We do know that we have to have ongoing work and supports for those students because a number of them were placed there because they had significant attendance challenges, and we're continuing to work with the staff to say, what else can we do to reach out to those families to make sure we get students in those seats. And we're looking at some other alternatives to do because we do certainly understand your concern, Ms. Cosby, about attendance and return on investment, the cost of the program, and making sure we're actually getting the most bang for our buck for the most part. The MSOU program, that will not be, it will be a full school day. It is a transitionary program, so the students will attend the MSOU program. And so if I'm a transitionary seventh or eighth grader and I'm successful, my next year, I will be in ninth grade in a comprehensive school. Those students, again, will have social and emotional supports. But we also, because we have, when you looked at our data, we had 300 and something students that would qualify for the program. We have 90 slots. So very competitive in terms of who would best be suited for the program right now, where we have buy-in for the immediate placement. So we have to make sure that we're very, very careful about our selection because unlike Aspire, a student can be placed in Aspire throughout the year. The MSOU program, you have to be, once you're placed there, you're there for the year. We can't swap kids in and out because of the way that the coursework is designed. So we have to make sure we're very purposeful with who is placed at the MSOU. And we want there to be voluntary participation. As we've talked about the program before, we want families who would meet that criteria to actually be able to apply for those positions for their students. So based on their willingness to apply, that says mom, dad, auntie, uncle, student, they're invested and they want to be accelerated into what the students refer to as their correct grade. And so we look at a number of things, but we certainly do understand that there's more work to be done with Aspire, and we're continuing to want to enhance that. And as Ms. Kane just reminded me, as we looked at our data too, both programs are similar in the fact that they're about dropout prevention because as they get older, students tend to disconnect from school.
Aspire, if I could. If we don't do some of the, if we don't have this Aspire program, those students are guaranteed dropouts. So we're saving the week. Look at another way to look at those is we have 22 of 44 students that are there today attending classes that if it wasn't for the program, they would not be in any of our schools. So the reason Aspire was put in was to try to last-ditch effort. So a student walks in, 19 years old, they dropped out last year. I really want to get my diploma. Well, I have two credits. I really can't get that over in my base school. It doesn't make sense. I would be 25 years old before I could graduate. Well, here's a tool for you, Aspire. If you go over here, you can take self-paced with small group instruction partnered with that, and you can graduate but you gotta be pretty motivated. But once you do that, you're technically enrolled at Richmond Alternative School, which is, Aspire is a program within that, and they are a student then of Richmond Alternative School in the Aspire program. So it fills an incredible important role Aspire does, but absolutely we got work to do. We're trying to get these middle school students before they get to that desperate situation of, I have no credits, I'm 20 years old with two credits, and I'm dropping out. So just a quick comment. Mike, Mr. Moore.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I fully support addressing the dropout challenge that we face, and I do think that this is something we have to address. I think some of the points that have been raised are good ones. And so I wonder, and this is just a question because I just don't know, is there a way to, for the next school year, do a smaller cohort, right? And almost like a pilot project and say, okay, here are some metrics that we know we can measure. Attendance, have they gone from two grades behind to one to a half a grade behind or something so we can see whether or not we want to invest, this type of money in this particular program.
Yes, and we, for those who weren't present on last year, we got to a similar place last year when we really started looking at the funding. The idea generally was supported, but the numbers, it came down to the numbers, and we just didn't have enough to go around for the many needs. So we did draft a plan. We actually, the 90 would be if we did a transition 6, 7, and 8. On the presentation that we shared with you all, that's when we had scaled it back to just 7 and 8, with 6 coming later. So we could do that with just starting with 7, with the transition 7 and transition 8. When you go below the transition 7, 8, we're paying more for teachers if we were just to do one grade level. So it gets a little funny because you're looking at 30 kids. With 60 kids, it makes a little more sense with the teachers that you would need. So the recommendation may be to, if we wanted to scale it back some, to look at just doing 2 grade levels as opposed to 3 and then adding it on. So that would give us time to, any hiccups, we could iron those out. It would be less costly than doing a full implementation. So I think that might get it what everyone's talking about. And I just want to share that, so we're just speaking on right now. We haven't had a chance to dialogue with the entire cabinet, so I hope I'm not speaking out of turn. But that's some immediate feedback.
The question I think was, what would we, if we just did 7 and 8, would we just cut a teacher or two? That doesn't.
So if my memory serves me correctly, we would cut one instructional assistant, we would cut one teacher. The administrator piece would still be there.
It hasn't been funded for the last 2 years. What can we do to I mean, I think this is pretty important. So what can we do to help build the case for this? Because it hasn't, I mean, I don't know. How can we help?
I think we're all doing that now, and certainly as we go forward to next week, and then well, we certainly have an opportunity, and Mr. Morgan can address us with a new mayor and many new members of council. We certainly have an opportunity to work with them and explain how important this need is.
My suggestion would be that when we go forward with this, if we're going to include it, that we focus on the problem we're trying to solve when we talk about this, and not the administrator, the teachers, the sort of technical explanation. I think we're trying to address a problem, several problems: dropout prevention, getting kids graduated on time, and so those are goals and challenges that I think everybody can rally behind, and so that's where I would start if we're going to go forward.
Madam Chair, the biggest teeth to this project, I think, is what I shared earlier, is a culture and climate issue, and the mayor's already sensitive to that. That's the lead soundbite that he is hearing himself and visiting our schools, as you know, with, and these are the children who are prone to acting out because they have lost hope or are being put back into the same environment where they haven't been successful. So to, I think, Mr. Bourne's point about solving a problem, that's one of the biggest ones that's jumped out. And obviously with the number of children that we have that are not being successful, but for me, remember my days in the classroom? This is what our teachers are seeing on a regular basis, and we have to try something different and give some different tools. I think Mrs. Dorr said she spoke to a number of teachers who have this, and that's really the biggest notion without still giving up on our children with regards to trying something different for them. I will tell you that I recently had a conversation, to your point, Ms. Cosby, about looking at what's the challenge with Aspire. We obviously knew that these are kids who had attendance issues, but the question is, are we being effective in how we engage them, and or is it the right people there to engage them to make sure they still want to come? So I would assure you that that's the question that I have, and whether or not, honestly, we've talked about whether we have to, if we don't get the right answers to those questions, do we consider redirecting that money towards one of the other programs? So we are going through that process also. We just don't have the answers yet. We can get, as we go down through this process, we could end up talking about the fact that we have to tweak that a little bit different or do something different with it to support one of the other programs. As far as, this was a program that's housed in a building that had space. We were trying not to make sure that we don't overwhelm a school that's already in denied status. So I want you to keep that in mind about TJ. So we wanted to make sure that it was a space issue. We did not have to put a principal there because the building has a principal, but we didn't want to take another 90 kids and dump it on the caseload of that principal in that school with the challenges they're already facing and still say, he can supervise, but he has the staff to run it, is what we were trying to put in the model, if that makes sense. And we left it as a program, so those numbers, I'm doing this from memory, are not dumped into his scores also, because there's a high likelihood that would pull him farther down. All of these programs are coded towards Richmond Alternative School. The philosophy was that we know these are most challenging and highly needy students, so the price tag is higher. And all the research tells you that all the more needs, the price tag is going to go up. But we also thoughtfully went after this, saying that if we're going to hurt a school, we're going to deem one school, so they're all coded as part of one major program, alternative education under RAS. Just so you know that, to keep from pulling down our comprehensive schools while we're using space availability. If that makes sense to everybody.
It
Des, I have just two quick comments. First, I would suggest, and I do not know, so I could be misspeaking, but if Aspire is not using a trauma-informed model, then that's part of the challenge. Because those are truly the most traumatized kids, and the traditional ways of disciplining that and teaching are just not going to work. So I just throw that out before this work. The second thing I want to say, I want to piggyback on what Jeff said about, as we go through this, you know, nuance, how many full-time equivalents. This really is about the kids, and I commend your team for taking the time to go through this line item by line item, because we have to do this. This is our responsibility as leadership. We have to take this information back to our community. We want to be the ambassadors who, when this is all said and done, can go out and promote and excite the community about making this happen. And having just left my district meeting, I can tell you right now the public is concerned, and there is a feeling of, are we being transparent? Are we being efficient? So it's not, when we ask these questions, it's not necessarily to cast doubt on assumptions, but to understand, to add value, and to really be able to walk out the door to be able to explain this to a public who doesn't have the benefit of. So I just want to say that, because, you know, it's like, oh my gosh, what time it is? Are you kidding me? We appreciate that, but we need to know. And as we continue to dig down, I just hope everyone keeps that in mind.
So you said this is coded as RAS. Will these be RPS employees running this, or will this be contracted out?
No, they're RPS. Aspire is RPS. The only school that has a collaborative partnership is RAS, the main building itself. I do want to highlight so that there's clarity, and you all may know this. The one thing that we did look at when I got here was what didn't work with the last model. And if you look at even RAS's current model, we have our own staff working side by side, because my lens was, we're not giving up our kids, but we're bringing some people in that right now are showing that they have more expertise than what we had. And the interesting thing is, Mrs. Cosby shared the data challenges with Aspire. RAS has the actual opposite now. All the attendance has gone up. And so we're making some headway on that, at least, compared to last year. I mean, last year it was like less than 50%, I believe, on regular. And we're hitting more of the, I think, closer to 70%, typically 60 and 70%. So it's having some positives. And maybe the half day is the challenge at Aspire that we have to look at. Does that model really work or not? But again, we walked in and knowing that we also put kids there with already attendance challenges. But we just talked about, do we have the right people? Do we have to tweak the model? Or if it's not working, do we redirect the funds to still work on this population of kids in a different way?
I promise this is quick. If we're serving the full population of kids, are there any, I mean, can we say if, you know, we think that we can increase our, by serving this population of kids, our graduation rate, our on-time graduation rate is going to be affected by this amount? I mean, is there any kind of macro level statistic that we can use to sell this program?
Well, we don't even know who the kids are going to be yet. That's going to be, you know, because I give you an example. I could be 1 year behind, but Abe could be three. So the makeup of the children. So I think the target has to be about the kid and how we move them, as opposed to, now ultimately the goal is to have those kids become more successful, get on track, ideally move on to graduation. The closer they are to, the less farther behind they are, the hopeful is that you're able to send them back to their zone school because they're in a better place, because part of the reason you just come up for school when you're two or three years behind is socialization and compulsory attendance. Yeah.
Oh, just to piggyback off of what Ms. Doyer said, I don't know if it's necessarily we can take this program, but maybe the AIP plan in its totality and what we are funding to come up with some outcome specific, I mean, or general range, I don't know, but some type of measurable outcomes to help us sell the story of the AIP plan. I think that's what we're getting at. So it might not be just with the middle school overage program, but we are funding that
and some growth things as well for the district, you know, additional foreign language and band, and those are some growth measurements and things, so, or initiatives.
Well, I think that to answer your question is clearly the board can choose to identify other types of targets. You know, we show that portable, that's not all we measure, so we clearly could say, the question it sounds like is, what are the measurements? You know, the FLES in foreign language is about access, another equity thing, and participation, that, you know, what does this bring to our children, the number of children being able to be served, for example, is a data point that you look at. You know, and then if we get to a point where we're able to track the children, what happens when they go on in their foreign language track is a conversation later down the road. So, that's something we can look at.
I'd even like to say it's something that we need to do. I think we need to start tracking it right now as we begin to fund it so we can report these successful outcomes. Let's plan for that, because if we don't start measuring, you know, what gets measured gets done. And I think that's something that is a board member I think we really want to see.
Thumbs up.
Now what I heard along with your post thumbs up is for me to go back with the team and look at some other more tangible things that we may be able to attribute to each of those that beyond the larger targets, can we attach some specific things to the individual items of how we're gonna see if we can say that there's actually showing some improvement. Okay.
Yeah, we really want to see measurable objectives, maybe quarterly, but you know, that can be discussed more in detail. So team 3 and team 4, we have not discussed that.
Would you like to hold on that till next week?
So might I just add that the electives teachers that have already been discussed, this is where we're going with it. It's not a different idea at all. This is to increase options for students at all of the levels. Really, we only have 3 here. So we're talking about arts, we're talking about music, we're talking about electives that really engage students in learning. So in addition to their core content areas, certainly we want to give students a reason to engage in school and to fully participate. And so electives is one way that we do that. So many of our students are involved in core courses and interventions, and it's, you know, all day long, reading math all day long. And students need an outlet. And so in order to engage students a little bit differently and hook them into learning, electives teachers are necessary. We do have electives teachers right now, but I can tell you that those courses, and as you talk to teachers, you will find that those are the courses that have the highest enrollment. Now, those are the courses that are generally intended to, but the numbers are significantly high. But that's what the situation is in RPS. So some of those are the reasons that we are asking for those positions. AIP team 4, those are the instructional assessment analysts. We currently have 3 on board, and those are the folks who work in schools. They help to disaggregate data, they help to gather data, they help teachers and administrators understand what to do next after they have gathered their data. So they are teachers, they're instructional, They work with leadership teams. They work hand in hand with our Office of School Improvement. We have a lot of data reports that are necessary to report to VDOE because we have so many schools that are priority schools and focus schools. We help schools to look at their gap groups. We look at school, help schools to work with their SPP, their school progress plans, and really use their data to plan next steps. How are we going to improve teaching and learning in schools? That's essentially, oh, and they do a significant amount of work, I didn't mention this, with a major professional development that we're doing to build data assessment analysis, and that's our DataWise process. So they lead that effort in schools.
So Dr. Kane, going back to team three, have you identified the electives?
Our students drive that. Our students in their course selections drive that. I'll give you a for example. When we first started to talk about what electives we would have and what electives would engage students, dance was one of those. So we needed to increase the number of dance instructors we had, but that was based on the student demand for dance.
And where will these teachers be working, any schools in particular?
Well, I can't identify those right now because, again, it's driven by student demand. So if we have a school that, you know, has a significant number of students in electives courses that have high numbers, 30s and I dare say 40s, because that does happen, then we'll look at those schools first.
If we approve this, how can we make sure that the resources are distributed equitably?
I would think that, and I apologize if I misspeak, but I would think that you would trust that that's what we do on a regular basis. We distribute our resources in the way that serves the greatest need. So that is what we look at. We look at that on a regular basis. Every year we do that, whether it's core or electives or whatever it is, exceptional ed or whatever it is, Dr. Ben.
So to give you evidence-based response, that's what leveling was that we brought back to make sure resources were distributed equitably. As a practical example of what this administration put back in place, it was because of the fact that you had some classes that had large numbers, and I'll use Huguenot for example. Huguenot was hitting 30, 35 kids to a class, and then we had other schools that were sitting at, you know, 15 and 20. And part of the thing was when we look at the student enrollment, we move the teachers where the students are and let that drive our staffing, because we have to get to a culture that we all work for Richmond Public Schools, not for a particular school. And that's been our approach, and that's been the model that we've tried to answer to here, that the resources go where the kids are. So just to give you a tangible example of how we do the staffing based on schedules and student demand.
Board members, we'd like to separate the items 39 and 40. More discussion regarding item 39. Where are we with line item 40? Okay.
add something about line item 40 for the AIP team 4 instructional analysts? We currently have analysts that serve each of the comprehensive high schools. So they all have an assessment analyst that they can rely on to help do the things that I said. That also helps to distribute some of the load from guidance counselors. Guidance counselors really have got to get back to spending 60% of their time doing guidance work. And right now, that does not happen. This current school year, we were able to hire additional assessment analysts to begin work in the middle schools, but we don't have enough to work in all of the middle schools. So right now, we are spreading ourselves really thinly because the AIP did request one for each of the 7 middle schools, but we have 4 currently. And so they are split between, and their effectiveness is certainly impacted by that. And the same goes for the school counselors at the middle school level. So this serves several purposes: professional development in analyzing data. It also serves as, you know, another resource for teachers, and they're in those classrooms side by side. They're planning with teachers. They're working with school leadership teams, Office of School Improvement, right in there, helping to analyze that data and determine what they're going to do, make instructional decisions to improve student outcomes. All of this is all based on improving student outcomes. So I just wanted to provide that as a little bit of reference for you as we look at both of those, at that instructional analyst.
Thank you. So Dr. Beck, moving forward, the board, we still have questions regarding team 4 instruction assessment analysts and the teacher contracts, professional development.
Yes,
right.
Ma'am.
39, thumbs up.
If it please, Madam Chair, and board members, if it's your pleasure, what we'll do is we'll take everything we talked about tonight and we will put it in a slightly different format. As Mr. Bourne and others have said, maybe the next time we talk through this, we won't have exactly the same amount of detail, but at the risk of sounding like your finance officer or accountant, we had board consensus on roughly $13.5 million of salary and benefits that we talked about again tonight. And here we're somewhere in the neighborhood of $3 million. So the original superintendent's estimate was around $2.8 million. And at this moment, just so when you walk away, we're all saying the same things. It feels like we have consensus on about $16+ million with some work to do, and understanding that there will be a number of additional meetings that will continue to set priorities. And at this moment, we do not know what either the state or city funding will be.
So for purposes of for Monday, the 6th, we have additional information regarding the student information system operators and line 40 and line 49.
Yes, ma'am.
So on the 6th, we can start that discussion and the redirected resources.
Yes, ma'am.
I think it's important that we just check in on our consensus, because I think some of them were not as consensus as we might have thought here. So I just think we should just do a pulse check among everyone on whether we are actually in consensus on the ones we talked. No, I think just privately.
Board members, if you have questions, please. Okay, but board members, we are meeting, work session, so if you have questions now, please, please ask your questions now, because this is the time to do that.
Opportunity to, irrespective of what perhaps was characterized as a consensus, to Liz's point, we'll have an opportunity to review those in a line item way, I presume, and call a vote on each of the call. What will the vote look like on Monday?
I may be able to help. A typical process for Monday would be to answer any additional questions that linger after today and provide some additional information. And one of the reasons that I wanted to try to put a parameter around where it appeared that maybe we were, was that roughly $16 million at this moment, the thought would be that would be your budget unless you're going to add something to it. Or potentially between now and then you take something away from it. But you'd be substantially finished by Monday with the anticipation of taking a vote, roughly on the 16. The big item still out there, of course, is professional development. So we'd have to have some additional dialogue about whether we were going to add that, and if so, what model would you prefer? But that would be the typical path or process for Monday.
I don't think that means that we couldn't move to vote on a specific line item should we need to, but to rehash every line item after we've done it the past couple of meetings would seem duplicative to me.
Is that?
So,
okay, to get clear understanding, there are additional questions regarding information system.
Right.
And then line 40, and then what option for professional development, line 49. Is that?
All right, so this was a work session. On Monday, we will be in a regular board meeting.
We will.
So at that time, we will be under Robert's Rules of Order.
Yes, ma'am.
So to discuss something, you know, there will be a motion, there will be discussion. And so if somebody wanted to say, I want to reopen line 43, that would have to be a motion and it would have to be approved.
I certainly don't want to give an answer for our attorney. However, we'll have an agenda item that we'll have an open discussion regarding the superintendent's estimate of needs. So we can have an open dialogue just like we did at our last regular meeting. There'll be an open back and forth, just like we're doing tonight.
Okay, and then we'll close that and go into our official.
And then there will be a request. After we finish all of that, then there will be a request by the administration to see if you're ready to vote.
Okay.
And at that point, then there would be motion, second, and approval.
Thank you for helping my ignorance.
That's at this moment what it appears the consensus is for.
So just doing backhand math, 3.4 million for six PD days, 0.2 for line item 39, and then 0.8 for a SysOp.
Yes, those are the three items that it looks like that we're, And we then,
but if you subtract 20, that's 22 minus 4 million is 18. So is, are we missing something?
You are not. The only other thing that, that we haven't talked about, and we held this to try to get through this tonight, is at your direction last week, you had asked the administration to identify some ways we can help ourselves. So we've identified what we think is about $1.5 million and some change that we're prepared to remove items out of the request. So those will not come forward.
So board members, just to make it clear, so we are comfortable with moving forward with everything except for line 40, line 49, and the student information system.
Great, thank you. Are there...
Ms. Cosby.
Yes, as it pertains to the AIP request, the additional 22 million, but we really have not. Are we, okay, my question is, there was an additional, there was a request for $22 million in addition to the 280, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And I'm saying, and I don't know if we really haven't looked at the 280. We focused on the additional $22 million, I mean, which is, you know. But there are some other questions.
We're going to assume, or are we assuming, that we're going to spend the full budget that we got for this at the end of this fiscal year, and that we needed every dime to do what we did in order to go forward and just add this on top of the budget? That's a really shaky, big assumption.
Very good questions, and this may help with the timeline. We talked a little bit about, and even Dr. Bed talked again tonight, about the period that new boards come on in this budget process. To set a new strategic plan, new direction, the in-depth review of is this particular before school program and this particular after school program, those discussions about adjusting existing classes, existing bus schedules, how many lunches we're gonna serve in our schools, those discussions about changing how we are delivering our services to our students will occur between now and the summer. And then the likely time for the board to work through that would be as we are going into the next budget cycle.
Ms. Owen.
Said, unless the city council, in its infinite wisdom and their desire to be collaborative, gave us every single thing we asked for, then we're going to have to go back and take a look at the whole thing, as has happened in the past, every single time. And at that time, we will be tweaking and tweaking and tweaking. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
And I'm sorry, and is there a I certainly don't want to suggest at all that we want to go look at this bus routes and decide whether or not we're being the most efficient, but there seems to be somewhere in the middle where we could do some assessment as to how accurate our budget estimates were for the current year. We could build on that. But I recognize the time constraint. I just want to go on the record that I'm not just giving a rubber stamp to everything we've done before isn't really in my comfort zone. I'm not saying I'm not going to support it, but I just really want to go on the record that that's troubling when we're accountable to the kids, right? It's not about what we want. It's what's working for this, what's working and what's not. So
board members.
I understand the time constraint. I really do, darling.
No, what I want to say, we approve the budget on the 6th of February, but also understand there will be more opportunities to tweak, massage the budget. This is not the end all, be all that saying is correct. So we still have more time. And yes, I understand, yes, we must be good stewards of the public dollars and making sure that our children have the resources that they need to be successful. But just to understand that this is an ongoing process that helps.
It's not to suggest we're being bad stewards right now. We're just looking for ways to be better stewards. Does that make it more comfortable? And so I appreciate the additional time. I just think that if what we're doing isn't quite working, then we need to shake some stuff up. And you start, it's great that we've gone to this level of depth with the additional resources. That's a big pot of money that we haven't really had the opportunity to dive into. Knowledgeably. And just getting the information isn't enough. Just like you did, Dr. Benton, with this. Here are the high-level assumptions. Here's the strategy that we're taking. Here's where we're trying to get. And so I'm glad that we'll have that in the future.
Madam Chair, a couple things. The conversation from the get-go was that the system is flawed the way it has the board come in. It's the same system the governor inherits when they change governors. The other piece I'd share with you is a lot of the line item stuff, just to remind you, you have access to. It was sent already, about a month ago. So you do have that document. So just remind you that if there are things you want to look at, absent of these meetings, that's available to you already. We've sent it to you. Thirdly, any major changes, just remember, 85% of your budget is people, 15% is roughly stuff. And if we're going to make decisions about people, when it comes to on the instructional side, there's language about how soon they must know. So there are other timelines, so just to make you aware, about contractual obligations, about notice and other things that we're required to give for contained contract teachers and staff that happen. And because, so as you prepare to want to dig deeper, remember there are other things that we may need to answer for you about timelines that are beyond just the budget timeline, of what personnel procedures and policies you have in place about notice that we are supposed to adhere to, just to make you aware of that. And considering that most of the money is tied up in people, just want to make you aware of that.
I don't want to leave the room to suggest that I'm looking at / staff. That's really not what I'm suggesting. I just want to have an opportunity, now here we will, to make sure we're being as strategic as we can in using the practices, the best practices that can change and get us to where we want to go, where we all want to go, that's all. And so it's not like I want to eliminate jobs, I just want to make sure that we're allocating things the way that we should. And we did get that information, and I appreciate that we did, but it's just a wealth of information without context. And it was just, again, like Dr. Benton did, here's high level, here's where we stand, here's what we're trying to get. But we haven't had that opportunity. So I know it's not a surprise, but I just feel like I need to say it. Because, again, when we go back to our districts and our neighborhoods, we need to explain why we said yes.
We also did not receive the 2018 full budget. We only received the 2018 statement of needs. We have the 2017 budget, right? But we don't have the 2018 budget.
We don't.
That's 2017, though.
And I'd like to, Ms. Doerr, I'd like to explain why. If we load this into that full budget, it would be extremely difficult to ferret out by line item what these numbers are affecting. For example, when you see what it costs for a particular position, that has salaries and benefits. So it would be hitting multiple lines. It would be very difficult to ferret that out. That's why we keep the adopted budget static while we review the changes to that budget.
So, board members, question again. What is comfort level going forward? We have already identified three items that need additional discussion on Monday. So what is the comfort level to move forward tonight? We're ready. We've beaten that horse.
Okay. We will prepare the information for the additional discussion items, put the budget together in a little bit different way that's going to come back to the $16 million, and we'll talk about what's the difference between the $16 million and the roughly $23 million, and we'll have that discussion. And at this moment, the agenda item will be to ask for your approval, so we can forward this to the mayor. And I will just add one more item before we wrap up tonight. There will be an agenda item for next week for you to consider a budget transfer that's going to begin to address our transportation situation. So we're going to have a discussion about how the budget, current budget and future budget, can address that. So we'll begin that conversation. But the timing is such that we will need to work through that next week as well, because we're going to have to get in front of the city administration and then city council and the finance committee and then set approval on second read. So those will be two financial things we'll have for you next week.
So Monday we'll be prepared to jump into this as opposed to providing the board another presentation.
Yes, ma'am. Well, that's the plan for next week.
Right, except for the additional details.
Yes.
Information. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Pursuant to the personnel section, the legal section 2.2-3711A7 of the Code of Virginia 1950 is amended, I move that the school board of the city of Richmond convene a closed session to consultation with legal counsel pertaining to actual litigation with respect to personnel matters where such consultation or briefing in open meeting would adversely affect the negotiating or litigating posture of the school board, consultation with legal counsel retained by the school board related to the potential filling of a school board vacancy.
Is it moved by